efficiently and reliably, and we've got to concentrate on doing that and maximising the use of this particular line, first of all.
Thank you. We now move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 14156. In the name of John Swinney on progress in the Scottish economy, members who wish to take part in the debate should press the request to speak button now. And can I point out to members that time is extremely tight this afternoon, and the last few speakers in the open debate may end up having their time slightly reduced. So can I call on John Swinney to speak to move the motion? Deputy First Minister, 14 minutes.
President Officer, today's debate provides an opportunity to reflect on the current strength of Scotland's economy. I'd also like to use the time that we have for this debate to outline the approach being taken by the Scottish Government and the wider public sector to build a Scottish economy that is characterised by inclusive growth and the creation of opportunities for everyone in Scotland to realise their full potential. Presiding Officer, this debate takes place against a backdrop of strong economic performance in Scotland. This is confirmed in the latest State of the Economy report from the Scottish Government's chief economist. It highlights that the Scottish economy has now experienced 11 consecutive quarters of growth, its longest period of uninterrupted economic growth since 2001. It also demonstrates the underlying resilience of the Scottish economy against the continued difficult external and domestic challenges that we have seen during this recent period. The latest data for the first quarter of this year recorded growth across each of the main sectors of the economy. There has been particularly strong performance in the construction sector, underpinned by our programme of continued infrastructure investment, with the construction sector demonstrating an expansion of 21% in its activities, a measure of the significance of the capital works that are currently underway in Scotland, which of course have just been referred to in relation to the Borders Railway. At the same time, consumption has been buoyed by factors such as high employment and low inflation. And in terms of GDP per capita, a key measure of our economic strength, Scottish GDP per head had recovered to just 0.2% below pre-recession levels by the first quarter of this year, while the UK as a whole remained 0.6% below its pre-recession peak in the same quarter. On employment, the picture is also encouraging. Our employment rate is above that of the UK, while youth unemployment is at its lowest level in 6 years. Our performance also ranks favourably in a European context, with the second highest female employment rate and the third highest youth employment rate in the European Union. Our strong economic performance is expected to continue, with the consensus forecast growth in Scotland this year of around 2.4%. And this recent trend picks up on a longer-term story of improvement. For example, the value of our international exports has increased by around 40% between 2007 and 2013. And in recent years, we have consolidated our position as the UK's most successful area outside of London in terms of attracting inward investment. As a result, over the last 10 years, Scotland has secured over 37,000 jobs from foreign direct investment. I'll give it to Mr. Stevenson.
Thank you very much. Will the Cabinet Secretary, Deputy First Minister, agree with me that with Scotland being one of the most successful exporting nations, it would be absolutely catastrophic to build barriers between ourselves and the rest of Europe?
Mr. Stevenson will be familiar with the commitment of the Scottish Government to the continued membership of the European Union. We believe that is an essential part of the economic prospects of Scotland, and of course there is a period of significant uncertainty with which the business community will have to wrestle in the course of the next few months as we await the timing of the EU referendum. So, of course.
Andrew Fraser.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. Given all the good news that he's referred to, why does he believe such a large gap has opened up in over the past year in terms of business confidence in Scotland, which lags very far behind that in the rest of the UK?
There's obviously a range of surveys about business confidence, and one of the surveys that I look at most closely is the Bank of Scotland Purchasing Managers Index, which has shown a sustained level of growing confidence within the Scottish economy, within the business community. And the reason why I look so closely at the Bank of Scotland PMI is that that is an index which, certainly in my experience, has come the closest to predicting some of the economic challenges and difficulties that we have had to experience. So therefore, it's what it reflects in terms of economic confidence, I think, is worth listening to in terms of the pattern of of that index. So, Presiding Officer, the foundations around foreign direct investment have been well expressed, but we've also seen business research and development spending in Scotland increase by 29% over the last 6 years in real terms. Our business base is also growing, with the number of registered businesses in Scotland growing by 10% since 2007 to an all-time record level. However, we know that there are areas in which we can do better and improve performance. In particular, we need to address structural challenges around productivity in order to ensure that skilled and well-paid job opportunities continue to be created within Scotland. Productivity has been a consistent theme in our approach to the economy since this government came to office, and it's an area in which we have enjoyed some success and made significant progress. Since 2007, the productivity gap between Scotland and the United Kingdom has been significantly reduced. However, we still lag well behind countries such as Sweden, Germany and France. At the same time, many economically successful nations of similar size to Scotland have also achieved greater levels of equality and better social outcomes. Whilst income inequality in Scotland, as measured by the Gini coefficient, is lower in the UK as a whole, it remains higher than in many strong performing northern European countries. We must do more to both increase competitiveness whilst ensuring that we also achieve a fairer society where the proceeds of growth are more evenly distributed. These mutually reinforcing priorities are central to our updated economic strategy. The strategy reaffirms our commitment to boosting productivity through investment, innovation and internationalisation. It also sets out an approach to the economy based on partnership and a commitment to tackling inequality, not just as an important priority and in and of itself, but as a means of boosting productivity in the economy. There is a growing evidence base that delivering sustainable growth and addressing long-standing inequalities are reinforcing and not competing objectives. This has been supported by recent work from the World Bank, the IMF and the OECD. And for example, analysis from the OECD found that rising income inequality in the UK reduced GDP per capita growth by 9 percentage points between 1990 and 2010. One of the, of course.
Tavis Scott.
I'm grateful to the Deputy First Minister for giving me on that point of income inequality. He represents a rural constituency as I do, and he'll understand the difficulties that the agricultural sector has faced this summer in particular. In that context, and in the context of his point about rural, about inequalities, would you undertake to look at some of the issues that are around the transportation of fodder to areas in the outlying part of Scotland that are facing particular pressures because of the summer that we've just had?
I think Mr Scott makes a very substantial point, and certainly on my a visit that I paid to Orkney, and indeed I was in the Western Isles just at the weekend, I was receiving representations about the difficulty, because of the inclement weather, in actually growing enough feedstock for livestock, which of course, particularly in Mr Scott's constituency and also in Orkney, are central, and the Western Isles, all of our island communities, are central to the livelihoods of individuals. So, as Mr Scott will know, the Rural Affairs Secretary was in Brussels yesterday discussing these very issues with his European counterparts, and we will of course consider as part of that analysis the substantial issue that Mr Scott has raised. The issue of income inequality and the tackling of income inequality has been central to the Government's economic strategy, and one of the members of the Council of the Economic Advisers, the First Minister's Council of Economic Advisers, Professor Stiglitz, recently commented that tackling inequality is the foremost challenge that many governments face. He remarked that Scotland's economic strategy leads the way in identifying the challenges and provides a strong vision for change. In practice, implementing the strategy will mean that we will focus on boosting competitiveness and tackling inequality through four key priorities: long-term sustainable investment in people, infrastructure and assets, growth based on innovation and openness to new ways of undertaking business activity, promoting inclusive growth and creating opportunity through a fair and inclusive jobs market and regional cohesion, and the creation of a country with an international outlook open to trade, migration and new ideas. All of these elements are essential to the process of wealth creation that the Government believes to be important in this exercise. Go away to Ms. Scanlon.
Thank you. I welcome the fact that you have acknowledged the disparity in productivity. Can I just ask if the first point in your investment strategy, the long-term investment in people, will that look at the drastic fall in opportunities at FE colleges, 150,000 fewer places for part-time, but will it also probably even equally as importantly, look at the opportunity at schools to do STEM subjects and indeed ICT subjects, which have also been cut drastically?
There are two points in Mrs. Scanlon's intervention. The first is in relation to college places, where the Government has taken a conscious decision to deepen the skills that individuals are acquiring when they go to college. Our commitment was to maintain the full-time equivalent numbers at about 116,000 at further education colleges. We've exceeded that at about 119,000. But the purpose of that was to concentrate deliberately on entrenching the skills base to ensure that the productivity gains that I'm talking about could be achieved because we had a more deeply skilled workforce. The second point that Mrs. Scanlon raises is in relation to essentially STEM and digital skills. And she will be aware that we have recently, in partnership with the industry, established CodeClan, which is the new digital skills academy, designed specifically to address the issue that Mrs. Scanlon raises, because I cannot have a conversation with the business community today without the issue of digital skills and their availability being raised. So the measures, we do realise that to be central to the development of the economy, and the measures are in place to try to address that. But of course, the Government will continue to reflect on how effectively that can be taken forward to ensure that we achieve these objectives. The strategy that the Government has set out makes clear our ambition is to reach the top quartile of OECD countries for productivity, sustainability, inequality and well-being. These are the aims of the Government's economic strategy. Our priority with regard to business is to build the conditions for businesses to grow both here at home and overseas, and to ensure that Scotland remains a highly attractive location for international investment. One of the first acts of the Scottish Government in 2007 was to establish the most competitive business rates regime in the United Kingdom. We've supported business also by directly maintaining the support to our enterprise bodies and investing, as I've just relayed to Mrs. Scanlon, in the physical and digital infrastructure and the skills of our workforce to support this activity. This, of course, has been against the backdrop of the public expenditure challenge that we have faced. Building on the measures taken over recent years, we announced further measures in our programme for government to update our activities and to reflect changing economic conditions both at home and internationally. And many of these aspects were set out in the programme for government debate in the course of the last couple of days. Presiding officer, a strong business sector is vital to the creation of a fairer society. The reverse is also true. A fairer society can benefit business into the bargain. That is one of the reasons why we will continue to place a strong emphasis on promoting fair work. We will promote the living wage, the real living wage, what makes work pay and it reduces poverty. It can also help businesses to increase productivity, to reduce absenteeism and to improve staff retention. Last year we set a target of 150 living wage accredited companies in Scotland. There are already more than 300 and we're now working on our target of 500 by the dissolution of Parliament. And over the next 6 months, the Fair Work Convention will create a new framework for the relationship between employers, employees and trade unions, public bodies and government. In particular, it will propose and promote employment practices at both the aggregate economy level and within individual businesses to maximise productivity, including in skills, workplace innovation and in job security. The business pledge is central to our vision of fair work, founded on a partnership between employers, employees and government. The business pledge is a shared mission between government and business with the goal of boosting productivity, competitiveness, fair employment and fair work. And by making their pledge, companies demonstrate their commitment to shared values and to deliver them through their actions and their future plans. And we're making strong progress here with the 100th adopter of the business pledge, Edinburgh-based games development company Blazing Griffin, announced only today. So in conclusion, presiding officer, fair work is is one strand of our approach to inclusive growth, raising attainment and eliminating gaps in attainment, the expansion of childcare provision and the wider provision of equality and affordable housing are other key measures to how we advance the efforts that we take forward to tackle inequality in our society. The Government's economic strategy has as its heart the determination to create a prosperous and a fair economy, but also to create a fair economy for the individuals of our society. At the heart of our approach is a focus on partnership and shared endeavour. We want to work with businesses and with all of our partners in the Scottish economy to ensure that our economy continues to grow and, most importantly, creates opportunities for all to flourish. I move the motion.
Thank you. I now call on Jackie Bailey to speak to move amendment number 14156.3. Ms Bailey, 10 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. We debated the Scottish Government's economic strategy in March. I think I described it then as a glossy and colourful publication with lots of pictures, but light on detail. And we anticipated today an action plan, timescales, targets. Unfortunately, not that much has changed. And there is really, really no room for complacency, because we know we have fewer businesses in Scotland per head of the population than anywhere else in the UK. There's actually been a fall in the number of businesses in Scotland. Our start-ups are fewer in number, business R&D spend is lower than the UK average, and our GDP is 2% higher than the pre-recession peak, but the rest of the UK's is 5% higher. Now, we could trade stats all afternoon. The truth is, the picture is very mixed. But don't just listen to me. The Federation of Small Businesses reported a drop in business confidence, now at zero, as revenues and profits fall. Importantly, they highlighted skill shortages as a real problem hampering business growth. The Scottish Retail Consortium also reported that retail sales were down on the previous year and food sales were down too. Now, few people would fundamentally disagree with the aims of the Scottish Government's strategy. Growing the Scottish economy, reducing inequality are sound ambitions, and we share them. The problem is, we don't know how the Scottish Government are going to do it, and we certainly don't know how success is going to be measured. Now, the First Minister, in her programme for government speech, made a plethora of announcements. I'm not sure how many are all that new. After all, I think, if my memory is right, this is probably the sixth time that the Scottish Business Development Bank has been announced. I look forward to it appearing soon. But it is the difference that these actions will make in terms of outcomes that matter. And with no measurements or targets, little means of judging whether that strategy is actually working. The Spice briefing on the SNP economic strategy is indeed well worth a read. It notes the lack of any smart targets, and if there are no targets, it's not possible to assess whether we are able to measure the success of the new strategy. I think Professor Ronnie MacDonald summed it up beautifully when he said, "This is really quite bizarre. If you don't have targets, it doesn't really take you anywhere." So we lament a lack of targets and measurements as a sign that the SNP aren't really serious about making this work. Let me turn to taxation. The SNP's previous economic strategy had an over-reliance on oil and a belief that if you cut the corporation tax, this would, in and of itself, promote growth. I'm pleased that they've moved away from that and recognise now what we've been saying all along, that cutting corporation tax would simply be a race to the bottom. As for oil, the SNP overestimated the amount of revenue that would be achieved from oil and gas taxation. Recent stats tell us that oil revenues for the most recent quarter were £168 million. For the same quarter last year were £969 million. Happy to give way.
Mike McKenzie.
Thank you for giving way. I wonder if he agrees with me and with Sir Ian Wood, a friend of the union, who said in his report on oil and gas that the fiscal regime and the regulatory regime had been extremely damaging for Scotland's oil and gas sector.
Becky Bailey.
Can I say I always pay careful attention to what Sir Ian Wood says, and I think some of his recommendations and his recent calls should be paid attention to by both the Scottish Government and the UK Government, because he is saying that oil production is unsustainable below $50 a barrel. And let me remind the member that the SNP told us that the economic projections for oil would be $110 a barrel. The figure has recently been revised down to $70 a barrel. The truth is that Brent crude fell to $42 a barrel last week. I worry about the sustainability of our oil economy. And this is not some debating point about the SNP's desire for full fiscal autonomy. This has real consequences. There have been more than 5,000 job losses. 35,000 job losses are predicted over the next 3 years. This touches every constituency in Scotland. But in Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire, the impact has been severe. Unemployment is going up. Youth unemployment is going up. Business starts are falling by a fifth, and 91% of businesses saying they had been adversely affected. So aside from the consequences of the fall in price, not at the moment, oil is in decline and the cost of extraction is indeed increasing. However much we might not want to talk about this, we need to start thinking now about a post-oil economy. What do we do about decommissioning? Let's have a clear strategy from the SNP government to bring investment to do that here. How do we make sure that the skills, the talents, the jobs in the oil industry transfer into the new industries of the future? There is little in the strategy about this. Now, members may recall back in March, the SNP government published two different economic analysis papers within a week of each other. This set out the benefits of improved economic performance and was the SNP's demonstration of how they would improve onshore revenue receipts and close the gap in the nation's finances. Aside from wrongly including the benefits of the Barnett formula in their calculations about full fiscal autonomy, the papers made a number of sweeping assumptions. We would see a growth in productivity, no underlying policy analysis for achieving this. We would see a narrowing of the gap between Scotland and our international peers on business investment. No underlying policy analysis for achieving this. We would see a 50% growth in exports, a growth rate higher than China's in its heyday. Again, no underlying policy analysis for achieving this. So let me go on with the sweeping assumptions for just a minute. All this would apparently generate £3 billion more in tax revenues. That's the SNP's best case scenario. Far be it for me to point out to the Cabinet Secretary that with a gap of at least £7 billion, he was a little way short, some £4 billion short. So that would mean a cut in services like schools, hospitals, reducing the number of teachers and nurses, or indeed it would mean higher taxes. But we've yet to hear which it will be, and the SNP is still committed to pursuing a policy of full fiscal autonomy that would cost Scotland's economy dear. Our focus for the economy must be forward-looking. We know that the Scotland of tomorrow will not be like the Scotland of today. And the greatest asset we have in the future is our people, because it's human capital that can actually drive economic success. So that means we need to invest in their potential. We need to give them the very best start in life, the best opportunities in school, access to further and higher education, and indeed lifelong learning. Education is an economic issue. Now, my leader, Kezia Dugdale, visited Selex yesterday to talk about the engineering jobs of the future. Engineering UK estimate that Scotland will need nearly 150,000 new engineers by 2022. And that's great. That could result in a £1.7 billion bonus to our economy. So why is it that a pathway to engineering course being offered at Dumbarton Academy in my constituency is being cancelled by West College? Now, I hope the Cabinet Secretary will agree that that's actually very short-sighted, and perhaps driven by financial considerations more than the needs of the local economy. Happy to give
Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. I do hope that she would agree that there should be a broader range of possibilities for those students at her local school than to see their future working in the arms industry in a business which has a track record of dealing with some of the most brutal regimes on the planet.
Becky Bailey.
I thank Patrick Harvey for his intervention. I think he'll recognise that what I was trying to illustrate is that there are jobs there in the future, principally in engineering, that was once considered an industry in decline, and this is something we should encourage. He is a former pupil of Dumbarton Academy. I hope would want to join me in seeking a reversal to the short-sighted decision made by the college to cancel a pathway to engineering course. But you know, employers complain about having a pipeline of skilled people. That's borne out by the FSB survey. So the jobs of the future need investment now, particularly in STEM subjects, science, technology, engineering and maths. But we need also to invest in the classroom in basic literacy and numeracy. There is little to celebrate when the attainment gap is 12% in reading, 21% in writing, 24% in maths. This fundamentally harms our economy. So the attainment fund announced by the SNP is welcome, but it needs to be made a budget priority as well as a political one. Presiding Officer, just contrast the approach of the SNP when they say that they will cancel £250 million of air passenger duty in a year when investing just £25 million in closing the attainment gap.
Ten times more
on cutting taxes than investing in our children and the future. Presiding Officer, our approach to the economy is about investing in skills, not cutting taxes, and I look forward to taking Scotland forward in the future.
Many thanks. I now call on Murdo Fraser to speak to and move Amendment 14156.2. Mr Fraser, 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I start by welcoming the scheduling of this debate this afternoon, and also the recognition from the Scottish Government in its motion of the fact that we are seeing steady and sustained economic growth. Over the past year, the UK grew faster than any other advanced economy in the world, and Scotland is very much part of that. And so too for employment, where we have seen unprecedented increases. This has been an employment-heavy economic recovery, and that has been central to the Conservative Party ambition. And I welcomed the Cabinet Secretary's narrative of all the economic successes. What, of course, he missed out was attributing those economic successes to their real architect, the Chancellor of the Exchequer, George Osborne. It was a result of his difficult decisions taken in the teeth of opposition from other parties in this chamber that we have delivered this economic success. Well, let's just remind ourselves what we heard from these other parties. We were told that economic growth would not come. When employment was growing, we were told that these increases were illusionary. Instead, the facts speak for themselves. We've had more than 2 million new jobs created across the UK in the last 5 years, three quarters of which have been in full-time position. For those in work, we have seen wages rise over the past year, increasing at an average of 2.8% in a period when inflation has been flat. And UK government policy now exceeds the pre-election pledges of either the SNP or the Labour Party in working towards an enforceable £9 per hour national living wage for 2020. I'm sure Mr McDonald would like to join me in celebrating success, so I will give way to him.
I wonder if the member could perhaps advise me on two things. Firstly, why is it then that poverty groups are saying that in-work poverty has increased? And secondly, can you advise whether the living wage as set by the Scottish Government would be above £9 at the time at which the Scottish, the Conservative minimum wage reaches £9?
Mr Fraser.
Well, on the second point, the living wage proposed by the Scottish Government would not have been legally enforceable. That is the difference. The national living wage we introduced will be legally enforceable for all over 25s. Everyone will get the benefit of that. It will not be a voluntary scheme. And I'm glad the member has raised the issue of poverty, because in their own annual poverty and income report earlier this year, the Scottish Government acknowledged that we had some of the lowest levels of poverty in Scotland since figures began in the first half of the 1990s. And according to the Scottish Government itself, which Mr Macdonald, I think, should pay attention to, there are now 140,000 fewer individuals and 60,000 fewer children in poverty since 2020. As the Scottish Government itself acknowledges in its report, this reflects more people moving into employment and increases in hours worked. In particular, there has been a shift from part-time employment to full-time employment for those on the lowest incomes. So the record is an encouraging one, although there is more work to do. But it is unfortunate that in the areas where it has control, the Scottish Government has set out a number of negative signals during its time in office. Now, we are pleased that a number of these measures have been reversed. For example, the so-called public health levy, possibly the most thinly veiled cash grab on the retail sector that has ever been conceived, which ended just this year. And if it really was about public health, why did it come to an end? And of course, we see the same cash grab instincts arising from the Scottish Government's treatment of shooting and deer forests in the Land Reform Bill, currently before this Parliament. Only yesterday I was talking to a gamekeeper concerned about the prospects for his own job as a result of this ill-conceived measure, where there is little consideration of how business is affected and how sectors of our economy will suffer as a result of these targeted attempts to raise revenue. That is regrettable. No, I'll need to make some progress. Thank you, Mr. Harvey. So 1 year on from the referendum, we also see the government continuing to agitate over the constitution. Now, with the odd exception, the Federation of Small Business has chartered business confidence in Scotland in relation to the rest of the UK over the past few years, as Jackie Bailey reminded us. And the latest figures do make for grim reading. Confidence in Scotland has fallen to a mere 1.7 points, while UK-wide it stands at 20.3. Over the last year, the gap between the two has widened. And I think the Cabinet Secretary, when I intervened on him earlier, was too quick to dismiss these figures. I think he should be asking why that gap exists and why it has been widening. That should be a matter of concern. But I want to say something about business rates, because I think if the Scottish Government is sincere about its intention to make Scotland a competitive business environment, it must follow its ambitions with actions, which is why we are calling for a root and branch review of the business rates system. And it's perhaps surprising this has not yet happened. The Scottish Government has established a Commission on Local Government Finance, yet excluded from its remit any examination of business rates, the single largest local tax in Scotland. So I would encourage a review to be established, and I hope it will be as open as possible, looking at the fundamentals of local business taxation. But there are also a number of specific problems in the administration of the current system which could be addressed. With the rise in rates for empty properties, for example, we are putting a large additional expense on properties which are vacant due to undergoing refits or refurbishments, already a considerable cost on business. For the whole of England and Wales, there is a single assessor for business rates valuations. What case can now realistically be made in Scotland for retaining 14 separate assessors? And why is there no single mechanism for payment rather than separate mechanisms for each of our 32 local authorities? Presiding officer, there are a great many issues that need to be looked at. I would urge the Scottish Government to address this question of business rates. I don't have time, Deputy Presiding Officer, to address the issue of the Scottish rate of income tax. I would simply remind the Chamber, I think business needs clarity on this so they know that we will indeed be competitive. The Scottish Government, I would say, just in closing, will get our support and that from the business community if they do the right thing to create a more competitive environment in Scotland. And I have pleasure in moving the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much. 6 minute speeches now, very tight for time today. Call on Mark MacDonald to be followed by John Pentland. Up to 6 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I think a couple of things that need to be raised from the earlier speeches, which I was going to touch on the topics during my speech. One of the things that interests me, though, listening to the contribution from Jackie Bailey, is that I thought we'd come to a degree of consensus. Patrick Harvey excluded on this, and I know he has a different view from myself, around air passenger duty and the benefits that air passenger duty reductions would bring for airports and economic activity in Scotland. And I thought the Labour Party were signed up to this. I now hear what seems like a rowing back on this from their front bench and a suggestion that they do not favour taking those steps to boost economic activity and support Scotland's airports. And I think that will be very, very interesting news for Scotland's airports, particularly for Aberdeen Airport in my constituency, where I know a number of potential routes would benefit significantly were that decision to be taken. Perhaps that can, perhaps the front bench can clarify that a little bit later on in their speech. The second point that Jackie Bailey spoke about, and it's very, I realise it's a difficult balancing act for the Labour Party to try and, on the one hand, appear concerned by the situation as it affects the oil and gas sector, and yet at the same time try not to act as though they're pleased by the situation that arises. And it's a difficult balancing act which the previous Scottish Labour leader, Jim Murphy, spectacularly failed to carry out. But the point is this. The point is this. The issue around when the oil price was high, it demonstrates the folly of the decision taken by the UK government to implement the supplementary charge, which therefore had a detrimental impact on the exploration activity at a time when the opportunity was there for exploration activity to take place. That meant that the industry, when the oil price lowered, was not in as advantageous a position as it might otherwise have been had exploration activity been stimulated and encouraged rather than being discouraged by that activity. But it would be remiss of me, Presiding Officer, during the period of Offshore Europe, which takes place in my constituency, not to focus on both positive developments and opportunities within the sector. And I note yesterday an announcement from Lloyds Register Energy that they will be developing a headquarter building at the Prime 4 Business Park in Kingswells in my constituency, which they say in their press release will be the largest LR office worldwide in terms of headcount. I think that's an important statement of confidence, both in the northeast economy, but also in the energy sector moving forward. And then I was drawn to an article on the Aberdeen and Grampian Chamber of Commerce blog today by Brian Wilson. And not often that you hear Brian Wilson being quoted on these benches, but it was one of his more temperate interventions, where he pointed out that in Azerbaijan alone, according to UKTI, there is £11 billion worth of export opportunities for British companies over the next few years as production of both oil and gas continue to expand. And one of the benefits that we have in Scotland and in the northeast of Scotland in particular is an expertise base built up over many decades which can be exported into other countries and can bring benefits both in those areas, but also, most crucially, can bring benefits back to Scotland as a result of internationalisation and export of both talent and also of hardware and kit. And the point on the living wage and the fallacy that Murdo Fraser makes and that the Conservative Party make is that just by retitling the minimum wage as the living wage doesn't make it a living wage. What makes it a living wage is whether it meets the standard as applied to the living wage, which is why when the Conservatives increased the minimum wage, welcome through any increase in the minimum wage is, by not increasing it to the level of the living wage as applied by the Scottish Government, it cannot then be called a living wage if it does not meet the criteria of a living wage, can it, Mr Brown?
Mr Brown, I'm grateful to the member for giving me. Would he at least acknowledge, though, that it is higher than the manifesto commitment of his party at the general election?
Exactly.
Tom MacDonald?
Just say yes.
Yes,
if all we're going to get from Mr Brown is this semantic argument, rather than looking at the reality of a living wage and what a living wage actually means, then we're not going to get very far at all. But I welcome the fact that in Scotland we see now nearly 135,000 people employed by living wage accredited employers in Scotland. And I welcome the fact that the target has not just been exceeded but smashed in terms of living wage accredited companies. And as a result, we're now looking for 500 by the dissolution of this Parliament. And the living wage is important for more than just the fact that it boosts incomes. It's also the fact that a workforce that is well paid and properly paid is a more productive workforce. And that links into the point about productivity that the Deputy First Minister made. Because if you have a workforce that is enthused by the fact that they're actually receiving a proper pay for a proper day's work, they then are more likely to be a more productive workforce, and that will bring economic benefit as well. So I believe, Presiding Officer, that there are positive stories to tell in terms of both the offshore sector, but also the wider Scottish economy, and I support the Government's economic strategy.
Many thanks. And I now call on John Pentland to be followed by Rob Gibson.
Presiding Officer, as the Government motion notes, economic growth was stronger and more sustained in 2001, Labour's second term of office. Famously, when talking about his economic strategy, Gordon Brown referred to post-neoclassical endogenous growth theory. Now, that may be a mouthful, but it's not just meaningless jargon. Underpinning it is the idea that by investing in education and skills, in tandem with support for scientific and technological development, we can make better use of scarce resources, perhaps even achieving the economist's holy grail of sustainable growth in a virtuous cycle where success breeds further success. Only time will tell if that is possible, but most economists would agree that high-quality training, skills and education, coupled with support for innovation, is an essential key to maximising growth. So when discussing the economy and the economic levers in the hands of the Scottish Government, we cannot overemphasise the importance of education and training. The more we invest in education, the better. Employers look for high-skilled workforce, and a reputation for skills and technological advances attract businesses. We need a coherent strategy to maximise our potential throughout schools, colleges, universities and employment-based training. So how, Cabinet Secretary, will you ensure that everyone can access the educational opportunities needed to build their careers? And as Kezia said yesterday, cutting the attainment gap begins in the classroom with the basics like literacy and numeracy. And the gap between rich and poor is immoral, and it's holding back our whole country back. That gap, you know, needs to be cut. We need to get more young people from deprived areas, such as those in Motherwell and Wishaw, into high quality apprenticeships, college and university courses, and good jobs. Unfortunately, there are still too many people left out in the cold with poor prospects, which gives a perception that the Scottish Government talks the talk but does not walk the walk. Cabinet Secretary, you're failing my constituency and others. When are you going to fix that? As well as quality, we need to ensure that we develop the right mix of skills, and that takes vision and long-term planning. But when you look at the shortages of teachers, medical professionals, scientists and engineers, you only see failure of foresight and planning. And as Nicola said in 2001, a party that is now in its second term of office cannot avoid taking responsibility for its own failings. And as Jackie Bailey said, Scotland will need nearly 150,000 new engineers by 2022. Failure to deliver engineering skills will cost Scotland £1.7 billion a year. And why is it, Cabinet Secretary, women constitute just 3% of civil engineers and 10% of senior managers in science and technology in Scotland? So what is the Scottish Government doing to attract more women into science and engineering? We need a firm foundation in science at primary. But how many primary teachers have science degrees, or even study science to a higher level? Done properly, studying science can enhance literacy and numeracy. Surely that would be more useful than reintroducing national testing. And why did the number sitting higher level STEM subjects fall to just 4.2% this year? Colleges, which are crucial to lifelong learning and tackling the attainment gap by widening access to education for disadvantaged areas, yet we have seen a three-pronged attack with cuts to staffing courses and 140,000 fewer students. And when it comes to apprenticeships, it should not just be about quantity. We need high-quality apprenticeships, and we need a range of skills. Of course, we need retail, hospitality and the service sector, but shouldn't there be a higher proportion in science, IT, engineering, technology, manufacturing, construction industries that are the powerhouses of wealth creation? We need to ensure apprenticeships are good quality and meet the needs of young people and the economy. So in summary, what we have is lack of science in primary, low take-up in secondary, courses cut to FE, too few graduates from universities and too few STEM apprenticeships. The government report card has must do better at every level. Presiding officer, if we want to build a fairer Scotland and a stronger economy, we have to concentrate on addressing these issues. That's what I want, and that's what Scottish Labour wants. But is that what the Scottish Government wants, or does it still have other things in its mind?
Many thanks. And I now call on Rob Gibson to be followed by Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to support the motion today on support for business, infrastructure investment, innovation and internationalisation, and promoting and expanding fair work. In my constituency, we can see major developments in renewable energy, for example, at Wick Harbour, where the Beatrice offshore wind project is going to use that for its base and make major infrastructure and job developments there. Offshore wind, which is only partly consented by the UK government and could be so much bigger than it is. But also, our Energy Minister, Fergus Ewing, has visited Maygen in my constituency, where, you know, he says that the eyes of the global marine industry are on this project. It's the first major tidal project in the world, and people are looking to it to see how to develop more tidal energy in the world. But we also have Scots who are internationalising by making sure that they gain contracts in other places to use our technology at the present time. Take Stirling-based Natural Power, which has got a job with EDF to oversee the health and social environment and marine operations at the Pampol Breha tidal farm in Brittany in Côte d'Armor. Also at the new one at Ile de Groix, I hope, and certainly at Saint-Nazaire offshore wind farm, areas which I visit in the summer, and they welcome Scottish technology to help them to prosper. At the same time, we are faced with a UK policy which has the Energy Minister, Amber Rudd, making a big difference in the way in which Britain is going about energy policy compared to us or Germany or anyone else. Amber Rudd has arguably the most expensive single infrastructure project in British history, the Hinkley Point C nuclear power station, which is their choice whilst they sabotage the potential for thousands of jobs and billions of pounds of investment in Scotland in our renewable industries. And I'm surprised that the Labour Party didn't notice in its talk about the post-oil economy that in the programme for government that we have invested £200 million during 2014-15 and 2015-16, including the National Renewables Infrastructure Fund and the new CARES Local Energy Challenge Fund to support the rollout of low-carbon energy, etc. Now, these kinds of investments are part of the post-oil economy, as are the report just very recently given to us by David Sigsworth, the chair of the Scottish Fuel Poverty Forum. And here's where building infrastructure comes off. He says, Scottish and UK government policies surrounding fuel poverty now contain significant differences of approach, given that Scotland is still tied to the energy company obligation scheme of the UK, designed and implemented by the Department of Energy and Climate Change. This has hampered the development of a uniquely Scottish solution. And in my constituency, the vast bulk of it has got homes which are between 60 and 85% in need of tackling fuel poverty, as does much of rural Scotland. Where are we going to get the money for these kinds of things? Into the bargain, the difficulties of the reserve powers are that we suffer other problems, such as the report today by Citizens Advice Scotland about the postcode penalty, the distance travelled, the cost of parcels to our rural areas. Can we do something about that? We can protest, but our economy can take off if we get a proper system of delivering parcels to our rural areas, and we need these powers. We don't have them at the present time. So let me suggest that it's important to look at the drawbacks that there are, but also the successes. We've got a record export in salmon farm salmon production this year. We could be taxing whisky at source if we had the power over the whisky industry here and not the international companies that pay some taxes elsewhere. And indeed, we also would be able to promote the fair jobs, which this government is famous for trying to promote. I was delighted that Annabel Ewing, our Minister for Fair Work, visited my constituency, the Gordon Bush wind farm, recently. And she shows that women are employed by Scottish and Southern Energy in many of these kinds of developments. But Scottish and Southern Energy are held back by the economy policies of the UK. I'd just like to stop for a minute and think about one of the issues in the Tory amendment, and that is the one about shooting rates and the removal of the dispensation to pay these. Well, if that's the height of their ambition for rural policy, about £4 million a year, I think we're seeing the white flag being raised by them. And, you know, the late Dick Balhari, the conservationist, said that the traditional shooting estates embody the selfish greed of a Victorian era, and most private landowners in Scotland are outdated and ludicrous, as are the arguments of Murdo Fraser. So perhaps we should look at the way in which we could give a bonus to estates which meet the targets for culling deer and also charge the ones who don't meet those targets with a lot, lot more charges than they're paying at the present time. Presiding officer, there's much to be said here, but my constituents and those across Scotland are being deeply wounded in our energy policies by the uncertainties of investment by the UK government.
Must close,
the SNP's
please.
Programme for government shows the way ahead.
Thanks so much. Now call on Claudia Beamish, to be followed by Joan McAlpine.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scottish Labour, of course, recognises the need for growth in Scotland. Jackie Bailey's amendment recognises that the Scottish Government must ensure that the benefits of economic growth improve the lives of working people and address increasing inequalities. In my brief, I'm committed to facing the future and want to step back and take this opportunity to discuss less conventional measurement opportunities for our economy. I would like to highlight the framework for measuring economic activity and promote alternative measurements. As one of the members contributing to the Cabinet Secretary's National Performance Framework discussions, I am clear that the significance of this for the Scottish and the Scottish Government being measured against this criteria is fundamental. To know Scotland's success, we need to ensure prosperity beyond economic terms and also in social and environmental terms. I am certain that factors such as quality and security of employment, mental and physical health, time with family and friends, access to nature, to name but some, are equally important in understanding the prosperity and progress of our nation. So can the Cabinet Secretary, in his closing remarks, update the Chamber on the scope and range and timescale of the review for the National Performance Framework? While the GDP framework has limitations of specificity, if I can say that word, excuse me, for innovative methods can go far better to reflecting the quality of life and sustainability, as well as unpaid and public services and negative externalities. As politicians, we should surely consider strongly adapting to a system of measurement that better explores our modern economy. Deeper understanding means better quality decisions leading on to public policy. I recognise the analysis by Professor Stiglitz, and I will look carefully at the Cabinet Secretary's 4 points raised today. We must seize the opportunities that the future holds and prepare for it today. The Government owes our communities a just transition, and central to this is the development of transferable skills. The recent announcement of the closure of Longannet plant was a devastating blow to local communities and those impacted by the knock-on and supply chain effects. As we shift to a low-carbon economy, there must be measures ready in place for those affected in this way. I mentioned earlier the importance of quality and security of employment, and so I was disappointed to learn that there appears to be no real strategy outlined by the Scottish Government for a just transition. A low-carbon economy is an inclusive economy, and whilst the shift is positive, provisions must be made for workers and communities in an incremental way to reach where we have to go due to the climate change imperative. A true example of forward-looking and creation of a new economy is also the circular economy. This, for those members who are not up to speed on it, which I wasn't a year ago, is whereby waste is practically eliminated by reusing, repairing, and remanufacturing materials and energy. And this could strengthen Scotland's economy through advancements in education, employment, and the environment. I am encouraged that the Scottish Government's current consultation on this subject is now open, and the acknowledgement of the breadth of opportunities that it will make available to Scottish industries and communities. And I would ask all MSPs in the Chamber and beyond to highlight this consultation to their constituents. I'm also clear that cooperative models can make a far more significant contribution to Scotland's economic future, urban and rural, in all sectors, from finance to energy. Is Cooperative Development Scotland adequately supported by the Scottish Government to mainstream this inclusive economic way of working? Looking to the rural economy, I must address the sector-wide crisis hitting our farmers after 5,000 farmers joined a demonstration yesterday in Brussels. I am convinced that the Dairy Action Plan is not moving as speedily as farmers deserve in the struggle with desperately low prices, market volatility and poor weather conditions. We must support the farming industry, and I urge the Scottish Government to take quick action also on new CAP delivery arrangements, as well as on long-term planning for investment and research to better help out our farmers. Many rural communities in my region of South Scotland and beyond can be found to be living in an economically marginalised way. I am confident that the Land Reform Bill, as part of the programme of government, holds significant opportunity for change, offering rural communities empowered and democratic input into their own economic future. The RACI committee received a vast number of submissions to the bill, which clearly demonstrates the significance of these potential changes. The Cabinet Secretary's motion looks to achieve, I quote, inclusive growth and opportunities for all, and I would encourage the Scottish Government to retain that ethos within the heart of the Land Reform Bill as it moves forward. Finally, this week sees the opening of the new Borders Rail line, and I congratulate the Campaign for Borders Rail on this success, and the Government and other parties. This development will benefit the Borders wage economy, tourism, connectivity for residents, while reducing carbon emissions, and is a huge boost to my region. And I agree with the Campaign for Borders Rail, which was raised with the Cabinet Secretary earlier, that we should consider very carefully the extent to which it can be extended to Carlisle. Sustainable transport combined with real broadband access still have a long way to go, and the Scottish Government needs, in my view, to get a better handle on both of these. Scottish Labour demands more for rural Scotland, and I support Jackie Bailey's amendment.
Thank you so much. I now call on John McAlpine to be followed by Tavish Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to speak in this afternoon's debate. Continuous growth over the last 3 years, despite challenging conditions, not only highlights the resilience of our economy, but underlines and embeds trends in the labour market, such as record employment levels and signs that real wages are increasing. Like many across Civic Scotland, I welcome the programme for government set out by the First Minister last week. It shows a government that's working hard to create a strong and competitive economy underpinned by social justice, which is bold in its ambition to make Scotland the best place in the UK to do business through a focus on skills, productivity, innovation and, crucially, fair work. This afternoon, I would like to focus on the last of these. As well as equal access to skilled employment, people's experience of work must be fair and promote opportunity, fulfilment, security and respect. The importance placed on this by the Scottish Government is demonstrated by the creation of a cabinet-level post with responsibility for its promotion. As part of this, the Fair Work Convention was established in April this year, which will be a focal point to develop, promote and sustain a fair work framework for Scotland. Largely due to the efforts of the Poverty Alliance and the Living Wage Foundation, the Scottish Government target to achieve 150 living wage accredited employers by the end of 2015 has been met 8 months ahead of schedule. And they are well on the way to achieve the revised target of 500 Scots-based living wage accredited employers by the end of March 2016. No thanks, I don't have much time. The Scottish Government itself became accredited in June. The UK Government recently announced an enhancement to the national minimum wage. It is more important than ever that the Scottish Government continue to champion a true living wage, the level of which is calculated according to the basic cost of living, taking into account the income that households receive via the welfare system. The new national minimum wage announced by the Chancellor is restricted to over 25s and is coupled with significant reductions to working age benefits. The programme for government also outlines the considerable track record that Scotland has built as a world leader in social enterprise and the social economy. And this is being modest. In fact, the results of Scotland's first ever survey of the shape, size and impact of social enterprise reveals that business is burgeoning, with over 5,200 social enterprise firms providing 112,000 jobs with assets worth some £3.86 billion. This is truly world-leading, not to mention the fact that social enterprise sector contributes £1.15 billion to the economy, as well as playing a pivotal role in tackling social issues. The gross value added figure is roughly £1.7 billion. This research, commissioned by a wide range of public and third sector groups, including the Scottish Government, Social Enterprise Scotland and Glasgow Caledonian University, confirms that Scotland is a trailblazer when it comes to nurturing social enterprise and validates the Scottish Government's decision to protect and work alongside the social enterprise sector, a sector which the UK Government has yet to fully grasp and embrace. There is a good spread of social enterprises across both rural and urban Scotland, and I always take the opportunity to highlight a success story in my constituency, and I'm going to do that now. The usual place is a community cafe in Dumfries, set up by two fantastic and innovative women called Linda Whitelaw and Heather Hall, who saw a gap in the market in relation to the training of young people with additional support needs. Working with the local college, the cafe will help train those youngsters up for a career in the hospitality industry. This is indicative of the progressive nature of social enterprises. Many work with those who are furthest away from the labour market, representing a fairer and more inclusive way of doing business. In terms of gender equality, 60% of social enterprises have a woman as their most senior employee. And not only that, but the sector is already achieving a 50-50 board member membership target. And a notable 68% of social enterprises pay at least the recognised living wage. It is clear that the social enterprise sector is playing an increasingly important part in Scotland's economy, and with their inclusive business practices will be important in the development of the Fair Work agenda. The Scottish Government, I'm very pleased to note, is already investing £5.4 million in the social enterprise development and will be strengthening the support available as part of the 10-year social enterprise strategy, which will be published next year, and I very much look forward to seeing that. So I'm very optimistic that with the Government's commitment, we'll see the sector grow from strength to strength and contribute to the overall success of the Scottish economy. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and thank you for your brevity. Now call on Tavish Scott to be followed by Chip Rovett.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In this week of all weeks, with offshore Europe starting today in Aberdeen, rather than talking down the oil industry, I think we should be looking at what it needs, given the importance of that industry to not just the Aberdeen economy, but to the Scottish and UK economies as well. In an energy supplement for the Press and Journal, Andy Samuel, the Oil and Gas Authority new regulator, said just the other day that the risk that is involved in low or negative profitability in producing fields could lead to the permanent decommissioning of critical infrastructure, with the potential to shut down whole areas of the UK continental shelf, stranding valuable resources. And that's a very in-oil way of saying that if price falls, oil rigs will stop producing, and infrastructure, pipelines and processing facilities right across Scotland and the UK will be under severe pressure, and some will potentially close. Andrew Samuel went on in the Press and Journal to describe in a diagram the facilities, many of whom are by definition, of course, in Scotland, but some are down the east coast of England as well, that face that kind of pressure. Now, one of those is Sullivan. Sullivan oil and gas terminal has been the centre of the North Sea for longer than I've been involved in many aspects of public life, and goes back to when I was growing up in Shetland. And the thought that now, for the first time, because oil prices, as some members have mentioned, are at below $50 a barrel on a consistent basis, there can be no doubt now of those dangers. And I think they are real and significant dangers, and therefore what needs to be done to tackle those. Now, It is not, as some keep saying, a matter of tax. If they were making money, they'd be paying tax. But most of the oil industry at the moment, indeed none of the oil industry that I know, is making any money. And Ian Wood, who rightly said just the other day that the best way that the UK government can assist at this time is with bigger capital allowances that do fluctuate according to the price of oil. He's argued that the OGA, the UK government, and the industry need to recognise that a mechanism that fluctuates, while to some degree imprecise, does at least allow for the investment that has been described in this debate already but must take place to continue rather than absolutely stalling that in terms of what is going on right now. The Maersk development that was announced just last week happened because of the previous tax regime introduced under the last budget, but that was then, and now we are where we are today. Oil prices are actually even lower than they were at that time, and that's why I believe that Sir Ian Wood's proposal in relation to some kind of graduated capital tax allowance to assist where price is low is something the Scottish Government should support, and it's something that the UK Government should absolutely introduce at the first opportunity, which would be the autumn statement later this year. Otherwise, I very strongly fear for a lot of the infrastructure and therefore for the jobs that go on in many different parts of Scotland, not least of which is at the Sullivan oil terminal in Shetland. It's as simple as this. If more and more fields are decommissioned, and just yesterday Nixon, who are owned by the Chinese state oil company, announced they are going to continue and indeed will decommission the Ettrick and Blackbird gas fields in the Upper Murray Firth. If that continues, if that trend continues, which remorselessly it would appear to be doing so at the moment, then the price per barrel made and the overall productivity will fall on the less fields and therefore on the infrastructure that is left. And that just puts into question the productivity and the cost basis for those facilities and therefore their continuing existence in their current form. And I think we are absolutely at a very sharp moment now in this area, and that is why the OGA Andy Samuels' protestations to his industry and therefore to the government as well and to others who can play a role in this to take this incredibly seriously I think are right and must now happen. The two other aspects to the oil industry that I do think are worthy of mention. The first that was mentioned by others is on decommissioning. I think the issue about decommissioning is actually that if tax relief is going to be applied to decommissioning, and that is clearly has become available through government, then that tax relief must mean that the jobs that go with the actual decommissioning work have to a great extent happen either in Scotland or indeed across the UK. That at the moment in one field I know about is not happening. The whole of the decommissioning project is going to Norway. There will be no UK jobs created out of that, none in Aberdeen, none anywhere. And I think that is just wrong if UK taxpayers' money is being used. And if the Conservative colleagues have any influence with their UK counterparts, I think they should press very hard for that system to be made much tighter indeed. And the final point is, and I think John Swinney, the Deputy First Minister, rightly mentioned this, and Jackie Bailey made something of engineers, that the Developing Scotland Young Workforce Programme is one of the best things that have come out of government in recent times. I believe it's a very important initiative. Rosanna Cunningham, I was very honoured to say, came up to Shetland in the summer to talk with local businesses about that, including with engineers, young engineers, at the North Atlantic Fisheries College in Lerwick. It is, in Scalloway rather, it is the way in which we excite and take young people, both young boys and young girls, out of an academic route that we still push too hard in our schools and to instead recognise that the vocational route into work is every bit as valuable as the academic route. We certainly need, as Jackie Bailey rightly said, more engineers. We also need more construction workers and care workers in passing, certainly in my part of the world as well. But in the context of the oil and gas industry, some more investment in young engineers and giving them a future means talking up this industry and not doing the reverse.
Many thanks. Now Colin Chick Brody to be followed by Margaret McCulloch.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome today's debate. But before I get into the meat of my contribution, may I address the commentary this weekend in the business news section of the Sunday Herald, where it reflected upon the briefing paper produced by Spice's Financial Scrutiny Unit, described by the report as a first in-depth analysis of Scotland's economic strategy, which was published by the government in March. The paper criticises the government's lack of economic targets. It states, and I quote, "Given the lack of smart targets, and with many targets to be developed at a later date, it is not possible to assess whether we will be able to measure success of the new strategy. It calls on such a luminary as Professor Ronald MacDonald, the Professor of Macroeconomics at Glasgow University, saying that an economic strategy that omitted measurable targets was, quote, really quite bizarre. And if you don't have targets, it doesn't take you anywhere. Well, what doesn't take us anywhere in the economy, as in other areas of public policy, is an obsession with targets. It's even included in the Labour Party motion today. Targets which are only right at any one moment in time. Had the Spice report and indeed Ronald MacDonald focused on outcomes and continuous improvement measurements, then the report and his comments might have had or borne some credibility and acknowledged the substantial economic growth that we've seen under this government. They and he didn't. To those who have experience in the real economy, that lack of credibility adds nothing to our pursuit of growth in that real economy. Reductions in inequality, increased economic growth and improved productivity will reflect real outcomes. Even in pursuit of these laudable outcomes, I could invoke no greater advocate than Jackie Bailey, who in May in the Labour Party debate said, and I quote, "Things have improved. I am thankful. I am thankful that the economy is growing. Employment is increasing and confidence is starting to improve." And of course she was right. No, I'm sorry, I can't take it now. The Bank of Scotland PMI report of 3 weeks ago stated, and again I quote, "Scottish private sector companies reported further growth of output and new orders at the start of the third quarter. The combined manufacturing and services index was at 52.2, up from 51.2 since June, a very marked rise since last December. Against a furiously challenging international market and an equally challenging and fluctuating currency market, the overall picture of input and output prices of backlog and employment, particularly manufacturing, indicates underlying resilience, strong resilience in the Scottish economy. What cannot be challenged is the outcome the continued expansion of Scotland's economy has had since the early 2000s. The quarterly National Account for Scotland report showed that the nominal cash value of Scottish GDP in the onshore economy has increased from around £74 billion in 1998, and by 2014, even after the global recession of 2008-2009, is estimated to be £140 billion in 2014, and GDP has returned to its pre-recession level. It's not just that. We've had 11 consecutive quarterly expansions in the economy at the start of 2015. Productivity rate has increased from 92.7% of the UK levels in 2007 to 97.7% in 2013, and perhaps the Conservatives will accept when they quote these figures that there's a major London effect in these UK numbers. Exports have grown by 40% since 2007. Gross value add in the services sector alone amounted to £53 billion in 2013. I could go on. The critical SME sector, though still needing some promotion and support, has benefited by the removal or reduction of taxation through the small business bonus scheme. Some 96,000 premises this year alone will benefit. And the new £40 million SME holding fund will offer microcredit, equity opportunities and loan facilities to accelerate SME growth. Presiding officer, from current personal engagement with foreign investors recently, with substantial funds running into the hundreds of millions of pounds available, be it for onshore fish industry, for renewables or social housing, these have all been passed to the agencies. The attraction of Scotland, the skills of its people, its willingness to encourage inward investors and grow an outward-looking economy cannot be underestimated. But that is not being achieved through spurious target setting, but by establishing outcomes based on continuous improvement, by developing the skills of our people, by investing in productive infrastructure, by eliminating inequality of treatment, conditions of employment, and remuneration, by creating more democracy in the workplace, by establishing fast and clear communication mechanisms like broadband All of these and more will underpin the growth of the key focus sectors like food and drink, tourism, manufacturing and so on. And we continue an economic growth predicated on that continuous improvement outcomes. So the measurement clearly is this. Indeed, are we performing better than we were last year? And the key indicators are that we're improving year on year. Current indications underpin that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now Colin Margaret McCullough to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There is no doubt that we are now seeing growth and recovery in the Scottish economy, but we have to put the welcome signs of progress referenced in the Government's motion into context. As mentioned earlier by my colleague Jackie Bailey, yesterday the Federation of Small Businesses revealed that confidence in the Scottish economy among their members was faltering. A fall in business revenues and profits has, in their words, served as a timely reminder that a sustained recovery is far from guaranteed. Meanwhile, forecasts for manufacturing growth across the UK have been downgraded. EEF, the manufacturers organisation, warned that the economy faces a roller coaster of risks, and they're right. Many businesses and investors are still reeling from last month's volatility in Asian markets and fears over a slowdown in China, while even now uncertainty remains over the future of Greece in the Eurozone. Much like the Scottish Government, the Chancellor has been trumpeting his successes, but he too would do well to put the UK's economic performance into context. We all know the importance of boosting productivity to people's wages and conditions, yet productivity has not returned to pre-recession levels, and forecasts for productivity growth have been reduced by the OBR for the rest of this decade. The Scottish Government must also be concerned about stagnant productivity growth and what it means for their own productivity targets of ranking in the top quartile of key trading partners in the OECD by 2017. I'm not alone in saying that the Government must be far more explicit about how the strategies and policies they're pursuing link to their economic objectives. Indeed, we as a Parliament must do more to interrogate the link between the Government's economic strategy and productivity growth. However, today I want to focus on local economies, Scotland's towns and town centres, their place in our national economy, and how we can support enterprise and regeneration in our communities. Just as city centres can drive growth in city regions, town centres can contribute to growth in our towns. We don't want to lose the economies of scale which make our cities so important, but we do want to maximise the contribution of our towns and help local economies reach their potential. Scottish Labour welcomed the publication of the Government's Town Centre Action Plan. It was not just a response to Fraser Review on town centres, but it was a clear, concise set of proposals to help communities realise the potential of their town centres. Central to that action plan was the Town Centre First principle, prioritising investment in town centres in support of healthy, vibrant local economies. When Falkirk Council, for example, were considering where to build their new head office, they decided to remain in the town centre because that's where the transport hubs are, that's where the infrastructure is, and that's where the footfall large employers generate makes the biggest difference on the high street. That's the Town Centre First principle in practice. Yet it's unclear how that principle applies to the rollout of superfast broadband and the Digital Towns agenda. The action plan makes specific reference to a future-proof fibre network in our towns, but right now it seems we're connecting up entire neighbourhoods without identifying where the business needs for superfast broadband are greatest. And I would encourage the Government to look into the matter urgently. I also want to raise the issue of business rates and the need for more flexibility in the system. The Community Empowerment Act gave councils the power to introduce local targeted rates relief. Taken together with the Fraser Review recommendations that the BRIS scheme should be expanded. These changes could add a new dimension to economic regeneration in Scotland and promote genuine localism.
Yet the Government has already introduced two forms of rates relief, which are specifically mentioned in the Town Centre Action Plan, to help businesses into vacant units. The New Start scheme provides relief on vacant new builds. Fresh Start applies to businesses taking on existing vacant properties. I had to use the Freedom of Information Act to learn that of Scotland's 32 councils, only 6 had granted an application under the New Start scheme. There had been more applications under Fresh Start, but these tended to be concentrated in specific local authority areas. This clearly isn't what the Government hoped for when the new relief schemes were introduced. You need to have a better understanding of why some relief schemes work but others fail, as councils gain new powers to direct discretionary reliefs of their own. And we absolutely need to do something about the cumbersome, time-consuming, costly appeals process that is clogging up local valuation boards and holding small businesses back. Presiding Officer, the progress we have seen in recent months is welcome, but it's also fragile and there are significant challenges ahead. Uncertainties in the global economy, the productivity gap, the uneven recovery. It falls to us, all of us, to do what we can in this Parliament to help our workers and our businesses build a stronger economy on firmer foundations. Prosperity and opportunity, not just for some, but for all. Thank you.
And I now call on Stuart McMillan to be followed by Mary Scanlon.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First of all, I do support the motion in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, and also I welcome this debate this afternoon. It is clear that the SNP Government has a strong economic track record and that this Government are working hard to create a stable and balanced economy that certainly is outward-looking and supported by huge levels of investment. Scottish GDP is above pre-recession levels and the economic outlook is the strongest it has been actually for many years. Scotland's economy has emerged strongly from the global recession and we now have lower unemployment and higher employment than the UK average. And this Scottish Government fundamentally believes that the decisions which affect Scotland should be made by the people of Scotland and also the people who actually live and work here. Even though, obviously, independence is our goal for the country, we will do what we can within the current constitutional arrangements and to achieve the best outcome for the people of Scotland. And it's for that reason, certainly it's for that reason that certainly with any additional powers that will come to this Parliament, then I'm quite sure that any SNP-led Scottish Government will use those powers to make the best of that particular situation. As I said, we've already achieved much in delivering certainly a positive vision for Scotland through some such examples as the commitment to fair work and a living wage, mitigating the worst effects of the UK Government's welfare cuts, focusing the efforts on tackling poverty, improving employment opportunities for women and young people, and expanding the provision of better housing. And a more inclusive economy is critical to boosting productivity. It underpins all the actions and activities, such as the living wage and addressing the educational attainment gap. And the austerity policies of the UK Government caused the recession to be longer and deeper than necessary. And as a result, many individuals and companies in Scotland have suffered greater hardship than they should. But with the powers available to us, this Scottish Government have actually worked hard to ease the impacts of recession and austerity on the country. As we know, colleagues, that Scotland has seen 11 consecutive quarters of growth, the longest period since 2001. And output is now above pre-recession levels, and there are record numbers of people in employment. And this is due in large part to the hard work, the talent and the entrepreneurial spirit that we see in businesses all across Scotland. And I'm sure that, that everyone in the Chamber all wants to see Scotland be the most competitive place to do business and invest in all of the nations in the UK. And I'm sure that all members across the Chamber will also welcome the introduction of the new £40 million fund to provide investment to small and medium-sized enterprises. And certainly, a growing part of our economy is that of marine tourism, which members will have heard me talk about on more than one occasion in the past. The marine tourism sector has actually got many small businesses who participate in it and actually who lead in that particular sector. And with the marine tourism strategy published earlier this year, and with the ambitious targets to grow that particular sector, then I would hope that many of the small businesses in that sector find this fund to be an opportunity to actually grow their businesses and then create more training opportunities and also create more jobs. There's another element of a successful element from this Scottish Government is that of the boosting productivity through the new manufacturing action plan, and also the aim for that is to develop leadership and skills and stimulate innovation and investment in Scottish manufacturing. Continue to support the creation of skilled and well-paid job opportunities, particularly for young people, to ensure that the benefits of economic success are shared by everyone. The plans, certainly from the Scottish Government, also continue. I mean, they include actually to invest in the skills base, to expand opportunities for young people, to prepare for work through developing the young workforce, developing the young workforce, the youth employment strategy, continue to support the hugely successful modern apprenticeship programme, having exceeded the target of 25,000 apprenticeships each year. That's going to be increased to almost 30,000 by 2020. Expanding coverage of the Scottish Business Pledge. Almost 100 companies have already signed up to this, committing to improve productivity, innovation and fair work. And also continue to encourage employers in all sectors in Scotland to embrace the value of fair work in paying the living wage and promoting an engaged, motivated and well-rewarded workforce. And it was only a few weeks ago, throughout the summer recess, I visited a small business based in Inverkip called Kirkpatrick Blaine. They're based in, they deal with the construction sector. They were recently accredited as a living wage employer. And my colleague Joe McAlpine touched upon earlier on the situation this year regarding gender stereotypes and working to support more women into the workplace, but across all sectors. And also, presenting officer, last week we heard the fabulous news of Ferguson's being the preferred bidder for the two new ferries for Seamal, £97 million. That announcement is brilliant news for Inverclyde and also the west of Scotland, and it's a real vote of confidence in the area. And so I would hope that, that when more employment is actually created, that many more local individuals get the opportunity to actually work in the yard and contribute to the building of these ships and also to the success of Ferguson's going forward. But the wider economic context presents real opportunities, certainly for Inverclyde, to develop a thriving competitive economy and also to help improve sustainable local economies. I could go on, presiding officer, but I know I'm short of time, but certainly I warmly welcome this motion in front of us from the Cabinet Secretary. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Now call on Mary Scallon to be followed by Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Before starting my speech, I would actually like to notify the Chamber that something very unusual, if not rare, occurred this afternoon, and that was that I actually agreed with Joan McAlpine. So there you are, only on one small part of her speech, and I don't often agree with Joan McAlpine, but on social enterprise, I think Joan McAlpine would actually find that there's not a single Conservative here today or on these benches that would disagree with supporting social enterprise. And if I may say, apart from the economic point of view, I'm particularly attracted to social enterprise because it brings people with mental health issues, it brings people who have drug and alcohol issues back into the world of work, and we should not forget it's not all about enterprise. And I've been delighted about the way that companies like the Shetland Bike Company, Shetland Soap, Rag and Tag, and I can see the Cabinet Secretary nodding, and I'm sure you're familiar, but it's what it does to transform people's lives. So there you are. I thought I'd take up a minute of my speech to mention that because it's such a rare occasion. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to look again at what Highlands and Islands Enterprise are doing in terms of investing in Lerwick? Because I know a few years ago when $34 billion price tag was put on to decommissioning, that they did say that they were looking at investing in Lerwick. And having listened to Tavish Scott today, I would be very concerned that we're missing the opportunity and that that decommissioning work is going to Norway and elsewhere. So we are very positive indeed about the recent growth in the Scottish economy, and predictions of further growth are welcome. And we also acknowledge that these encouraging figures are undoubtedly reflective of the United Kingdom Government's long-term plan for economic growth, with 174,000 more people in work in Scotland since Conservatives came to power in 2010, an average of 100 more jobs every day in Scotland, and more than 38,000 long-term unemployed, often described as the hard-to-reach, more than 38,000 Scots finding a long-term job through the work programme with the two-year support that comes along with it. No one's mentioned the personal allowance today, and given that we're looking at inequalities, I think we have to acknowledge that the personal allowance for paying tax has been raised to £10,600 and next year up to £11,000, and there's no doubt about it in relative terms that that benefits the lower paid considerably more and has taken 261,000 Scots out of paying tax altogether. Various speakers have mentioned boosting productivity, which is key to our nation's competitiveness, and also that Scotland suffers from the persistent productivity gap with the rest of the United Kingdom. Although there wasn't much in the government's economic strategy last week, I did listen to what the Cabinet Secretary said, and I always think the first part of addressing a problem is to acknowledge that there is a problem, so I'm taking it on trust that he will now come forward with some action to address the productivity gap. But the Scottish Government is now championing growth, which it claimed could not happen under UK government policies. And as Murdo Fraser said, any proposals to foster a more competitive economy in Scotland will receive our wholehearted support. But I notice the government claims in the motion that it's investing in skills and raising attainment, and yet its decision to drastically cut the funding for further education and science and technology courses in Scotland seriously undermines this claim. The government's record on further education is something I've been constantly critical of. Almost 150,000 part-time college places and 74,000 fewer learners aged over 25. Now, the idea that anyone over 25 is less in need of an opportunity at FE is to totally misunderstand the job market today, and also to assume that part-time courses are hobby courses is a failure in understanding again. But over 9% fall in college staff and a 12% cut in the college budget is undoubtedly not equipping young people and people of all ages, indeed, with the skills they need to compete in our economy. I'm not surprised that the business community are talking to John Swinney regarding skills. And if I can just look at the STEM subjects, the teacher census of 2014 showed that there are 383 fewer maths teachers, over 4% cut in teachers for biology, chemistry and physics, over 6% cut in computing science, and with the pass rate for higher maths at 34%, there's no doubt that serious challenges are being faced. And the Science Council predict there will be over 7 million jobs in science and technology across the UK, and unless we change in Scotland and provide people with the skills, we will undoubtedly be left behind. I see I'm running out of time, so I'll just mention the Ian Wood's workforce, which we fully support. And finally, I think that for those of us at the CBI dinner last week, I think Sir Tom Hunter's advice to John Swinney, which I don't mind repeating today, was get on with using the powers you have and stop moaning about the powers you don't have. I think that was very good advice.
Thanks so much. Now call on Richard Lyle to be followed by Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to open my remarks in this debate by saying loudly and clearly that I believe that this SNP government has a strong record on the economy and is doing everything it can to work hard to create a strong and competitive economy for Scotland. That looks outward is underpinned by the values of social justice and fairness and is supported by investment. Examples of which can be seen within my own region, and I look forward to sharing these later in my remarks today. It is important, Presiding Officer, to highlight some key facts about where we are currently at in Scotland. Our GDP is above pre-recession levels. Economic outlook is the strongest it has been for many years, and this is because this Scottish Government is working in taking forward our nation. Government is working hard to ensure that our economy is resilient, and I am sure it recognises that a pivotal aspect of ensuring that we can build a strong economy and a fairer society begins with our children and young people. Children and young people are often called the future, but I believe that they are the here and now. That is why the First Minister's programme for government education is at the heart of our efforts to not only ensure that we have children and young people who have the best possible start in life and indeed the support they need to grow and make a difference to life here in Scotland, but also crucially that they will be essential in building the strong economy which we all want to see. I want in my remarks this afternoon to highlight an excellent example to the Chamber of where this Scottish Government is playing its part in supporting industries, but also supporting our economy through support, but also recognition to enable employment opportunities and development. BioCity, based in Newhouse, just off the M8 motorway in my region, is a prime example of where the Scottish Government are offering their support to ensure the continued success and growth of ambitious life sciences businesses in Scotland. When I visited BioCity, I found it encompassed 130,000 square feet of state-of-the-art laboratories, access to shared services, business support and investment. It is, in its own words, a hothouse for growing life sciences talent in Scotland. I'm therefore particularly delighted by the recent announcement made by this SNP Scottish Government that BioCity site will be awarded enterprise status, and I thank the Minister for that, to continue to support and develop a site which is delivering opportunities not only for the local area but for Scotland as a whole. I also want to highlight this Government's support for the industry, and therefore I would hope that the Chamber would welcome the announcement of the additional £1.84 million of funding through the City deal for a new medical technical facility called MediCity at BioCity site in Newhouse. Through this investment and recognition of BioCity as an enterprise site, the Scottish Government are putting their money where their mouth is and is investing in people. The contribution they are making will ensure that investment and delivery, I hope, long-term employment opportunities for the people in my area and across the country. On business under the SNP, Scotland has the most competitive tax, business tax environment across the UK, with a package of reliefs worth £618 million for 2015-16. This Government is working hard to ensure a supportive business environment by retaining Scotland's enterprise bodies, in contrast to the actions of the UK Government, which abolished regional development agencies in 2012. A pillar of our efforts, and one which can be seen in communities across Scotland, is the introduction of the Small Business Bonus Scheme, which has removed or reduced taxation for over, as has been said earlier, 96,000 premises this year alone. 96,000. That's a huge number. Benefiting from actions by this Government. And I'm sure this Government will continue to do more to protect small businesses as they add great value to Scotland's economy and our communities. Finally, in business, I want to highlight that this Scottish Government has shown its commitment to creating a greener Scotland and growing a low-carbon economy. According to a Scottish Renewable report, already in the renewable sector, there is support for over 11,000 jobs here in Scotland, and we must continue to, no, I've not got much time, to champion growth in that sector. I also want to highlight in my region a recent planning decision by the Scottish ministers at a site close to BioCity, I mentioned earlier. It has the potential not only to reduce carbon emissions through a model shift from road to rail, but also significantly and importantly, even amongst the most conservative of estimates, will contribute to at least 1,000 extra transport jobs to the local economy. But forecasts for job creation are set around 3,000 jobs. Not only does this truly deliver upon employment opportunities for local people, North Lanarkshire having the above level of unemployment, indeed youth employment, unemployment, this is an important step to ensuring that people have access to jobs and in turn will create and contribute to economic growth. I'm nearing the end of my reflections. I want to highlight some other incredible work. Food and drink, valued at £1.5 billion. Also, we discussed a couple of weeks ago, film and production industry in Scotland, £45.2 billion. the Enterprise Areas Living Wage Reduction Scheme. So much this government has done. I want to conclude, Presiding Officer, by highlighting once again this government, I believe, has a commitment to ensuring that we have a sustainable and growing economy that delivers new opportunities for investment and development, but one which serves the people of Scotland and offers them the opportunities to shape a better future for us all. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm now going to call Mark Griffin. Can I just remind backbench members that the speeches are now 5 minutes? So it's Mark Griffin followed by Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think the key to continued progress in the Scottish economy is addressing the attainment gap and equipping the future workforce with the skills they need to succeed in the global economy. Now, we see report after report being published which point to a shortage of STEM skills and the huge opportunities that will be in those fields. The most recent report, which has been touched on by other speakers, Engineering UK 2015, the State of Engineering, highlighted that by 2022 there will be an additional 150,000 engineering jobs in Scotland, and that if filled, these jobs have the potential to generate an additional £1.7 billion per year to the Scottish economy. Now, we know Scottish engineers are world-class and world-renowned, and engineering makes a vital and valued contribution to the economy. Engineers will be at the forefront of developing solutions to the big global challenges of climate change, ageing populations and supply of food, clean water and energy. And that all sounds good, but the report also states that we are falling well short of the numbers needed with the right education and training to fill those highly skilled roles. Now, these are exactly the types of jobs we should be giving our young people's skills to do, highly skilled, highly paid jobs where we need to be aiming for, because we know that we can't compete with emerging economies for those low-pay, low-skilled jobs. There was a similar report published by the Learned Societies Group, which also makes stark reading. And one of the key points, again, and that was touched on by Mary Scanlon, is the expectation that by 2030, over 7 million jobs in the UK will depend on science skills. Again, those STEM jobs are exactly the kind of jobs we need, high-quality, high-skilled and highly paid jobs, which other emerging economies will struggle to compete with us for. And yet here, where we have that competitive advantage, we're choosing to throw it away. By 2030, the 4- and 5-year-olds who've just started school this summer will already be in work or possibly the final years of study at university and about to enter the job market. But those same pupils with the same academic ability and the same aptitude for science in England will have enjoyed over 10 years of state education, with 80% more per head spent on science in primary school and 27% more per head spent on science in secondary school if current spending levels continue. A massive head start in building the necessary skills to compete for those 7 million jobs in science. Now, there are two issues which need to be addressed to give young people or those adult learners who want to retrain the skills they need to compete for those engineering roles, and I think they fit within the government's four priorities set out in the government's economic strategy paper. Investment in education, skills and health needs to be focused on the areas with the biggest potential for growth, and inclusive growth can't just be an aspiration. We have to direct funding towards supporting key STEM skills in our schools, colleges and universities, and the attainment gap must be addressed. In purely economic terms, the attainment gap is holding this country back. We're wasting the best natural resource we have, failing the country and failing families from disadvantaged backgrounds. Now, we've debated these issues countless times. We've debated the shortfall in funding for science equipment in Scotland's schools, where spending is lower in Scotland, and that 98% of schools rely on external funding for practical science education. We've debated reductions in science technicians in schools, the staff that maintain and repair what actual equipment there is left in schools. We've debated in the reduction in computer science teachers and the fact that Many high schools don't even have one. We've debated reductions in teacher numbers, we've debated reduction in support staff, we've debated the issues around educational inequality. But, Presiding Officer, while the debates have been running, what's actually been done about it? The skills shortages for the high-quality science and engineering jobs of the future haven't been addressed, and the attainment gap stubbornly persists. Until these are tackled, we're missing massive economic opportunities, and any economic growth will fail a basic fairness test. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I just remind all members, after you make the speech, you are supposed to be here for at least the two speeches that come after yours, and you're supposed to be here for all of the closing speeches. I noticed that Mr. Lyle contributed to the debate and immediately left. I now call Dennis Robertson, followed by Patrick Harvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, this afternoon I found some of the contributions quite depressing, in that we seem to be saying in areas we must do better or we don't have. Presiding Officer, we have a very vibrant community. We are a very vibrant Scotland. We have actually demonstrated within many industries that Scotland is actually on the move. We have a can-do attitude, and actually the Cabinet Secretary launched the Can-Do Action Forum for the Entrepreneurs of the Future, investing £3 million in that project. When I was listening to the contribution from Jackie Bailey about the North East and in areas like my own constituency, I didn't recognise some of the aspects that she was talking about. Yes, there has been a downturn in some of the employment. But this is not just due to the oil price and the fall in the oil price. The industry, many months ago, in fact, about 2 years ago, had decided they needed to look inwardly at how to be more cost efficient. Now, yes, the oil price has a factor in this, and it does have a factor to play in the downturn. But the infrastructure programmes within the North East, and certainly my own constituency, are creating jobs. If I look at what's happening within the A96 at the Inverramsey Bridge, that is on time, on budget, and will be completed next year. Not at the moment, thank you, Jackie. And when we look at the infrastructure in terms of the rail project between Aberdeen and Inverness, that is certainly on track. And we will have the Kintore station there by 2019. There is jobs within the industry. We have a new campus at Afford in my constituency. Again, the creation of jobs within the construction industry. Food and drink within my own constituency is booming, Presiding Officer, booming. We're actually looking at the increase within the sector. We're looking at increasing the tourism within the Aberdeen to Deeside area. We're looking at the completion or the continuing of the development and looking forward to the completion of the Aberdeen Airport development. All these are very positive. There are positive things happening within the North East. And one of the most positive things, Presiding Officer, was the acknowledgement, an acknowledgement with the schools, the North East College, the universities and business that they needed to work together. Because in the past they'd worked in isolation. The universities and colleges were turning out people with degrees, looking at what do? We're going into the oil industry, or we're going into food and drink, whatever. Now they're looking at what do we need to produce? What do we need within the North East and beyond? And when I say to Mark Griffin, basically, yes, we can work together, we are working together, and we are creating the people for the future. Engineers, yes, and women in engineering. That has been something at the backbone of what has been happening in the North East. And it is about working together instead of isolation. And instead of making complaints and moaning that things aren't happening, look at what you can do. Look at what is happening. Look at how we take people forward. Because the negativity of going forward and saying it isn't happening is putting our young people off. We need to encourage our young people back into that industry, not put them off. Presiding Officer, small and medium-sized enterprises are extremely important within my constituency as well. And John Swinney has recognised that the SMEs are the backbone of the continuing development and growth within Scotland. And again, there's been money put aside to try and ensure that SMEs have a way forward, because they have struggled. They have struggled in trying to get money from the banks. But there's a £40 million loan fund there. And creatively, and with the Scottish Development Business Bank, that money will be available for the SMEs. Presiding Officer, there is, I think, a good story to tell, and we should be telling a good story. We should not be talking the government down in terms of its work, its progress, and its commitment to the people of Scotland. We are on the right track. We are developing. We are taking the country forward. We are creating a future for our young people. I was talking with Gordon McInnes from Skills Development Scotland, and he said to me last week at an Oil and Gas UK meeting, why didn't I bring up the gender question? Well, that was the first time I never brought up the gender question at the Oil and Gas.
You need to close, Mr Robertson.
I will, indeed, Presiding Officer. And the reason I didn't bring it up, Presiding Officer, is because I heard about the magnificent progress that is happening within the oil and gas industry and within Nixon and the development within the fields. It is happening, Presiding Officer. And I'll close there. Thank you.
Thank you, Patrick Harvey, followed by Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One of the little quirks of parliamentary arithmetic in the current session is that even on those occasions when my amendment isn't selected for debate, it's still no less likely to be agreed at decision time than if it was on the business bulletin in front of us. The Cabinet Secretary, though, when he spoke about strong economic performance, if he read my amendment, he won't have been at all surprised that Greens still regard his concept as based on too narrow a metric, both of growth or indeed of employment. He also talked about recovery, and he knows well that since the economic crash, the financial crisis which precipitated the events of the last few years and finally made it impossible to ignore the inevitable failure of the neoliberal economic model, I've long argued that economic recovery cannot simply mean the refloating of a failed model. It has to mean addressing the underlying diseases. But I don't think this debate should be an opportunity either to crow about a government that can do no wrong or to condemn a government for unmitigated failure. Neither would be an honest position. We should reflect carefully on the scale of the challenges which face us if we are remotely serious about having an economy which can meet the real needs of people while still respecting the ecological limits that the planet, in a non-negotiable basis, sets down for us. In terms of social impact, there is good stuff to talk about in the Scottish Government's agenda, from promoting the living wage and some aspects of the business pledge as well. These demonstrate good intention. Both could go further, in my view. But let's recognise the scale of the problem. Even the Government's own economic strategy at figure 1.3 shows the scale of increased income inequality since 1997, with the top 17%, the wealthiest 17%, as the only people whose wealth has increased as a share of the overall national wealth in that time. And the top 1 or 2% get the lion's share of that. There may be limits at present to what we can do to turn that around, to reverse that growth in inequality. But those limits will reduce in the next parliamentary session, and we will have more levers at our disposal. It's going to be important that we use them. In terms of workplace exploitation as well, I'll quote from Graham Smith of the STUC, who noted the massive 19% increase in the number of people employed on a zero-hours contract in the last year alone. It is time, he said, for politicians at all levels to quit trumpeting record employment levels and actually start interrogating what is happening in the labour market. That inequality on health and education shows itself, as we all know far too well. And when Murdo Fraser condemned the cash grab instincts of the Scottish Government, I do hope that he'll equally condemn the cash grab instincts of the high street restaurant chains, which are happily grabbing as much of their own employees' tips, their own underpaid employees' tips, as they can manage to get at the moment. That's the kind of reality that far too many people are facing in the economy at present.
Mark MacDonald.
I wonder if the member recalls, because I don't, Murdo Fraser condemning the cash grab instincts of the Conservatives when they hiked VAT to 20%, which squeezed the margins for many small enterprises in our communities.
Patrick Harvey.
I'm sure that both of us will search in vain for those quotes. As for the ecological impact, the environmental impact, again, the Scottish Government is due points for good intentions, and it certainly contrasts with the UK Government's attitude on renewable electricity, for example. But there is still a gap between intention and action. We hear about progress on CO2 emissions, but the legislation requires a recognition of consumption-based emissions. And that's where we're still clearly failing. We're not running an economy which is living, I'm afraid I don't have time, within ecological limits, as Global Overshoot Day, getting earlier and earlier and earlier every year, shows. We're still living as though we have another planet to move to. And as for the Scottish Government's own strategy, again, talks about a fundamental transition of all sectors of the economy. I agree, and I wish only that that was happening, but the failure to recognise the need for divestment from the fossil fuel industry, I'm afraid, belies that.
You need to start to close.
On wider economic factors, there are other things which are not being addressed. The level of debt, and specifically private debt, the structure of ownership in our economy, and fundamentally, presiding officer, an assumption which still holds that a deregulated free market model is capable of meeting the needs of our society or of the planet. It was never true, and it won't be true.
Stuart Stevenson, followed by James Kelly.
Thank you, presiding officer. One of the interesting things whenever Jackie Bailey brings forward amendments to motions is to look at what she wants to delete from government motions. And the first thing she wants to delete is celebrating that we're in the longest period of economic growth. Obviously, that's not something the Labour Party wants to celebrate, and I diverge dramatically from the position that Jackie Bailey takes in that regard. However, I can agree with her that it is important that we look at educational inequality. Investing in people who are not performing so well, who have unrealised potential, is a proper moral and practical thing for us to be doing. It will, of course, create additional jobs in educating people who need additional help. That's good. It will, of course, bring those people to the job market and make them more effective contributors to our economy and society, and that is good. What it won't do in the short term, of course, is improve productivity in our economy, but it is something that we most certainly should do. I think, presiding officer, we've got to think about what kind of jobs we're going to have in the future, what kind of future our economy and employment in it can look like, not just this year, next year, 5 years, but in 20 years' time. And I think there's a range of things that perhaps have not come up in this debate as yet. I think there are inhibitors in the way public policy works that, if allowed to continue unchecked, will make things more difficult. For example, many businesses in this part of Scotland find it difficult to get deliveries because via parcel services and others, because there is not an adequate universal service provision. We see, I heard of someone who couldn't get something delivered by Amazon to Aberdeen because the material concern had the potential to be flammable, and Amazon said that it would have to cross water to get to Aberdeen. So the whole issue of the delivery services that inhibit the receipt of goods and services by areas of Scotland is significant, and indeed in the opposite direction, the ability for goods and services to have their goods collected from their premises is inhibiting economic growth and development in many areas of Scotland. There are some good and underexploited areas that we might think about. I have a Betamax tape. I can't read it anymore, and it's something that's actually only 25 years old. And yet I have a piece of family paperwork from over 200 years ago that I can read. And the National Library of Scotland are actually taking a leading role in protecting the records of our country from obsolescence through technological change. They are developing ways in which electronic databases can be migrated over time. Paper has historically looked after itself, but in the modern world, with our storage of information largely electronic, there's a huge risk we will lose lots of that information. So I think the government should be encouraged to support the National Library of Scotland. That will create a specialist skill in Scotland that will be of great benefit all over the country, all over the world, and create commercial opportunities. We've got to improve the delivery of electronic services to everyone in our country. We've got to come up with technological solutions and investment to support the 5% of us, and I include myself, and I speak with a heartfelt plea, who are on exchange-only lines who cannot be connected to fibre optic cable. I make a little plea, and I see Mr. Johnson is similarly difficulty. Yesterday I had lunch at Herge's on the Loch in Tweed Bank. Thank you, Borders Rail. I now want to move to our building the case for Buchan Rail, because Fraserburgh, 15,000 population, 37 miles from the nearest railway station.
You need to bring your remarks to a close.
The population, 19,000, 32 miles from the nearest railway station. That's the next big rail project. I hope the government looks at that in early course. Presiding officer.
James Kelly, followed by James Dornan.
Thank you very much, presiding officer. As ever in these economic debates, speakers on different sides of the chamber will trade statistics in order to try and back up their case, you know, which is understandable. You do need data, I would point out, to check Brodie. You need to look at the data to monitor how the economy is growing or not growing, as the case may be. But I always think it's interesting when you reflect on your own constituency to look at the conversations that you're having locally. Murdo Fraser told us that he was speaking to a gamekeeper yesterday. Unfortunately, there are not any gamekeepers in Cambus Lang and Rutherglen. but that's maybe an economic opportunity, you know. but what strikes me is that in speaking particularly to young people who are maybe leaving school or college and university, among some of them there's an element of frustration that the jobs that they do are low quality, they're not well paid, and they're not very fulfilling. At the same time, when you speak to some businesses, there's also a frustration that they're not able to recruit people who are sufficiently skilled to fill the roles in order to exploit the economic opportunities that they're looking for to make the best of their businesses. And I think that those kind of conversations play into the points that some in the debate have made about the skills shortage. I think the point's been well made about we need 150,000 engineers by 2022, and we need to do significantly more to get more women engineers and promote women in these positions. I think it's also true in relation to information technology. There's been a real growth in the app economy. I'm sure members, you know, sort of 10 years ago, I certainly wouldn't have known what an app was, but nowadays everybody's into their phones and adding the apps on. There's going to be, by 2018, across Europe, there'll be 5.8 million jobs in that economy. That's a growth of four times in recent years. So I think there's a real opportunity in Scotland to, you know, grasp this, but you know, there needs to be some pace to it, there needs to be some urgency to it. And when you look at a situation where teacher numbers are falling, and some of the speakers in the debate, you know, gave specific examples around maths and physics, and also the numbers studying and passing exams in engineering, you know, we need to look at what's happening in the classrooms and also what are the requirements for college and university courses, not only if we're going to fulfil the skill shortage that there is just now, but if we're going to meet that gap that potentially exists by 2022. So there's a real job there. I think the other thing is that on the living wage, I'm not going to rerun the debate from last year, but what I would like to see the Scottish Government do is demonstrate, as he said at the time, what they're doing to ensure that the £10 billion of spend that they've got in procurement, they're doing to promote the payment of the living wage and contracts which they influence. I actually agreed. Mark MacDonald quoted Brian Wilson, said it was unusual to agree with him. Well, I actually agreed with Mark MacDonald. There you are. I don't think I've ever said that before. But he made some good points about payment and the living wage in the private sector. There's a new McDonald's restaurant opening in Rutherglen shortly with the creation of 65 jobs. I welcome that development in the Rutherglen constituency, but I want to see McDonald's in Rutherglen paying the living wage, because that will not only make a difference to the 65 people that work there, it will make a difference to McDonald's itself, because it will ensure that the people there are motivated and they'll provide a good quality service. And it will also ensure that you've got people who are being decently paid, who are then spending well in the local area, and that will promote the Rutherglen economy. So I urge McDonald's to listen closely to that plea. And summing up, I would urge the Scottish Government to listen to the advice that's happening on the ground, look to the future opportunities, and to promote fairness and promote people in the economy, because that can make a real difference.
James Dornan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I just back up what Dennis Robertson was saying? At a personal level, when my granddaughter starts university next Monday, and she's going into the earth sciences. So, and I know she's not alone, so it's good to see that women are following in that career path. And I'm sure, knowing Abigail the way I do, I'm sure she'll be a great example to everybody else who follows in her footsteps. But anyway, going back to the debate, we've heard both sides of the economic debate today. We had it was the Tories that done it, courtesy of Murdo Fraser. You're rubbish, we'd be better, courtesy of Jackie Bailey and many of the other speakers from the Labour benches. But the Cabinet Secretary and others have highlighted the benefits of the hard-working policies that have been implemented by the Scottish Government. So I don't feel that I need to go over that. But what I would like to do is I'd like to highlight a few examples from my own constituency of how small businesses, organisations and people have grabbed the opportunities offered to them to grow their business, improve their own lives and therefore improving the economy of the country. We've seen a welcome increase, as was mentioned earlier on, in the number of registered businesses in Scotland, now at a record high of 166,000 in 2014 figures, a national increase of 10% since we came into office in 2007. Two examples in the constituency are one next door to me. This is a bit unfortunate for me when I'm trying to lose weight, but next door to me is a company called Bakey Cakey. Guess what they do? And this is a woman who is a fairly high-ranking civil servant, and decided that what she wanted to do was she wanted to be self-employed. Not in Scotland, she was working in Westminster. She came back to make her home again in Scotland and took the opportunity to build this business. I'd love to say she's rolling in dough, but I can't say that for a certainty. My apologies, but it was there. I had to take it. But it seems to be a success. The place seems to be busy, and that's great. Great neighbours to have. The other one's a Dandelion Cafe. This is, again, two women who decided to take the opportunity, the economic climate and the opportunities in Scotland have given them, to take over a derelict tennis pavilion in a lovely local park in Newlands Park and create a small cafe. Now, I opened the Newlands Fete on Saturday, where this cafe is, and I have to tell you that the queues round the... I couldn't even get into it because the queues were so busy. So that was a very, very encouraging to see. And not only have they taken advantage of this, the opportunities that are here, but they also assist in providing a vital link in the supply chain of small independent businesses in Glasgow and the surrounding areas. One of the many reasons, for many reasons, not least the economic well-being of the country, education is at the heart of everything that this government does. And it's vital that flexibility is in the system to reach those that traditional methods fail to engage with sufficiently. Now, that's why I'm delighted that Newlands College, Junior College in my constituency, the work they're doing, they work with pupils to find mainstream education challenging and unresponsive to their emotional needs. The course dovetails the academic component focusing on English, maths, sciences and IT, along with vocational training in areas including engineering, music, technology, etc. This mix is also tied up with vocational training and is underpinned by motivational coaching such as the Duke of Edinburgh training, etc. It's been great. Everybody who finishes the course is guaranteed an apprenticeship or a place in college, and it's this flexible approach that tailors education to the emotional needs of pupils that will help to bridge the attainment gap. Other policies, such as curriculum for excellence, will help raise attainment and provide children with the flexibility required. We should congratulate Jim McCall for his foresight and determination in establishing this new centre of learning. I also think that it's important, and I see I've got about a minute left, but I see that the role of housing associations is vitally important here as a social enterprise. I'll take Castlemilk Housing Association and Castlemilk, just one of the number of housing associations in my constituency who are doing great things in terms of employment and making sure that their areas are better places to live in. They've got the Castleton Group, which is from the Community Woodlands Project through the Nursery and Housing Association. They focus on being a thriving social enterprise, providing unemployed graduates with hands-on experience across a range of internships. They've received funding from the People in the Community Fund for paid positions for three people for 6 months. And Castleton's record is impressive, with 80% of volunteers and interns finding employment after their experience. This is why I'm pleased that this government is encouraging and nourishing the power of affordable, social, community-minded landlords and not selling the stock from under their feet, as is proposed by Westminster. So there are many challenges facing our country, but when I look at the growth of businesses in the constituency, the falling unemployment figures in Cathcart, and new exciting educational opportunities in my constituency, I appreciate the positive changes that the government and its local partners has made. However,
Thank you. Just as important,
I look
forward.
Your
time has ended. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I now call on
Gavin Brown? Mr. Brown, you've got 6 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, we've had the usual array of contributions, I have to say, to the economy debate. Once again, with the SNP members blaming everything on the UK government. But we had a first today, one I hadn't heard before, and one which was uttered by backbench MSP Stuart McMillan. And Stuart McMillan, I quote, blamed the recession of 2008-09 on the austerity policies of the Conservative government from 2010. Now, he may well have been told this in his briefing, Presiding Officer, but I think even the most hardened nationalist would struggle to blame the 2008-09 recession on the policies from 2010. But perhaps we will hear the answer, so I will give way to Stuart McMillan.
Well, I thank Gavin Brown for taking the intervention. I'm sure if actually Gavin Brown tomorrow looks at the official record, he will actually quote correctly what I actually said, because it wasn't just that particular point, there was something else after it as well. If he looks at the official record, he will be able to see that as well.
Mr. Brown.
But he didn't deny saying that the austerity policies caused the recession, Presiding Officer. But of course I will check the record this afternoon and indeed tomorrow morning. So we agreed with the first part of the government motion, perfectly sensible, but thereafter we didn't. They asked us to endorse their economic strategy and support their programme for government. So I was interested last week to hear what we were going to get in the programme. The First Minister, with the usual modesty of the Scottish Government, described it as a vision for the coming decade and was quite happy to say that today she was setting out a bold ambition. So I was interested to hear what she had to say and indeed to read the document, but I have to say I think she was somewhat overselling the case, because there was the usual padding, rehashing of policies, reheating of policies and re-announcements, sometimes for the fifth, sixth or indeed seventh time. But what it lacked, Presiding Officer, was genuine meat. What it lacked were new policy measures that could actually underpin the ambitions which all of us have for Scotland. There was very little in there. Let me explain a little, because I read through it line by line and we heard that there was going to be a new infrastructure plan. We heard there is going to be a manufacturing plan in the autumn. There is going to be a social enterprise strategy next year. There is going to be a cyber resilience strategy in November. There is going to be a refresh of the oil and gas strategy at some point. There's going to be a trade and investment strategy later this year. And it goes on, Presiding Officer, the government's strategy appears to be filled with the idea that our strategy should be to have more strategies. And that actually doesn't take us anywhere. And the reason I'm so critical here is because 12 months ago, when the government announced their programme for government with the appointment of the then new First Minister, said almost exactly the same thing. We were going to have all these strategies. They repeated it again when they announced their economic strategy, and they repeated it again last week. Saying you're going to have a plethora of strategies is not the same thing as actually having a strategy and having some hard policies in place. But what about the actual policies that we heard of? I'm happy to
give the word
to Mr. Robertson.
Thank you very much, and I thank the member. With regard to the strategy, the member accepts that the Oil and Gas Authority, led by Andy Samuels, was convened by Westminster Government, and it's a question of working with both governments to ensure the best outcomes for the oil and gas industry for the future.
Mr. Brown?
I don't disagree with a single word that Dennis Robertson said there. I'm not sure why he felt the need to make it at that particular point, but I don't think it defends the government strategy in any place, but for the record, I agree exactly with what he said there. But in terms of actual policies that they put forward, what were they actually announcing? Well, they announced that they were going to have a Scottish Business Development Bank, Presiding Officer. Now, the only problem is that they announced this 2.5 years ago. Then they scrapped it. Then they re-announced it, then they scrapped it, and it has now been re-announced 3 times in the last 11 months. And we hear that we are going to hear more about it by the end of the year. That is woeful, Presiding Officer. That shows that absolutely no work whatsoever was done before it was first announced. It just sounded like a good idea. And 2 years on, we're no further forward. We don't have any detail on what it's going to do. Presiding Officer, we heard about the other flagship policy, the Scottish Business Pledge. Now, a perfectly admirable policy, a policy with which it is difficult to disagree, but if you look at what has actually happened on the ground, it's not quite as impressive as the government liked to make out, because this was given the full authority and backing of both the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister. They both put their stamps on this policy. They launched it amid much fanfare back in May. It has a dedicated website, a dedicated phone line, and the government put a lot of stock into it. 3 months later, the government proudly say that we have 100 businesses have signed up to it. 100 businesses, Presiding Officer. Might sound depressive initially, but when you hear that there are 80,000 businesses under the small business bonus, or indeed 300,000 businesses in Scotland today, the idea of having had 100 sign up to it after 3 months is not quite so impressive. So, Presiding Officer, in closing, let me hear from the government when they close. What actual policies are they going to put forward to deliver the ambitions that all of us have for Scotland?
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Brown. Can I call on Siobhan McMahon? Ms. McMahon, 7 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's debate has been an important one for our Parliament. Like many of my colleagues across the Chamber, I would rather focus my contribution today not on how we as a Parliament can foster economic growth as a means to an end in itself, but instead how we can encourage our constituents to reach their potential and reap the financial rewards. I'd like to start my speech on a positive note. I believe members from all sides of this Parliament accept the principle of a fair day's pay for a fair day's work. And in this regard, the Government's commitment to promoting the living wage to the private sector is well worthwhile and ought to be congratulated. We already know over 400,000 Scots are paid less than the living wage, with around 51,000 of them residing in the Central Scotland region I represent. A living wage would mean, on average, an annual wage rise of over £2,600 for every one of them working in a full-time position. I know that I'm not the only parliamentarian who has heard from both employees and employers of the benefits of paying the living wage, benefits that extend not only to the workforce receiving more equitable wages, but to employers. Research from the Poverty Alliance suggests that there is a direct correlation between paying the living wage and a 25% fall in absenteeism, a positive impact in recruitment and retention of staff, and that some 80% of employers believe that paying a living wage has enhanced the quality of work of their staff, as was acknowledged in the Cabinet Secretary's opening remarks. We know that the economic benefits of the living wage are impressive. Staff receiving the pay increase are likely to spend the money within their communities and on the businesses we rely upon for our economy to prosper. However, the government's record on this issue is not perfect. True, the Scottish Government is a living wage employer and is rightly praised for it. However, many of the less glamorous jobs in the Scottish Government's offices are outsourced to private sector companies who are under no obligation to pay cleaners, janitors or kitchen staff the living wage, something those they are catering and cleaning for take for granted. Scottish Labour have brought forward proposals in the past to this Parliament calling on the Government to rectify this. These proposals were supported by trade unions and charities alike from across Civic Scotland. They demanded that the Government use their powers over procurement to promote the living wage in the private sector. In contrast to the stated aim of the Government's motion, the desire to build a better, fairer Scotland, where our growing economy is used to improve the condition of the low paid, the Government rejected this. I am pleased to speak in support of the amendment put forward by Jackie Bailey today. It reiterates our values and our priorities, none more so than in the last line where it is written, "The foundation of Scotland's economic strategy must be a successful education policy, and that therefore tackling education inequality must not only be a political priority, but also a spending priority." Our new leader, Kezia Dugdale, has spoken eloquently inside and outside of this chamber about the need to make sure our schools are world-class centres of learning and argue strongly that we should not settle for standards to remain satisfactory. However, I would like to take this opportunity to talk about school leavers and once again challenge the position of the Scottish Government on further education. As someone who went from high school to college and then on to university, I can personally attest to the importance of a college sector in preparing young people either for work or, as in my case, higher education. We know that it is predominantly people from less affluent backgrounds who go to colleges. With that in mind, it is difficult to understand how the Government can claim to be pursuing an economic strategy categorised by inclusive growth and opportunities for all, when we know that we now have 140,000 fewer Scots going to college than we did when they took office. As John Pentland and Mark Griffin said, we need to do more in this area in order to tackle the attainment gap that is seen as a priority of this Government. As members in the Chamber will know, I am passionate about seeking equality for disabled people in our society. It is because of this that last month I submitted a Freedom of Information request to all 32 of Scotland's local authorities, asking for the number of staff they employed in schools specifically trained to support pupils with additional support needs. It found that the number of these staff members had declined in 22 of the 32 authorities, an overall drop from 3,363 in 2012 to 2,963 in 2014 across Scotland. I would urge the Scottish Government to urgently investigate this matter as part of their overall growth strategy. How can we, as legislators, hope to maximise the economic and societal potential of some of our most vulnerable people when, as they increase in number, we cut the specialist support available to them? The Scottish Children's Service Coalition have already warned that these cuts to support staff could lead to the prospect of a lost generation of young people. Add to that the fact that children identified as having additional support needs disproportionately come from lower income families and areas of high deprivation. Let's remove barriers, not allow them to creep up. I've previously called on the Government to use the public sector socio-economic duty to properly scrutinise the legislation they make, and I believe the example I've highlighted above is the perfect example where the Government could use this. Before moving to my new position within the Scottish Labour Finance team, I was a party spokesperson for women's employment, therefore it would be remiss of me not to at least touch on how we can better encourage growth with the maximum societal benefits by opening up metaphoric doors for women. The fact that 98% of construction apprentices were male and 97% of children's care apprentices were female in the flagship modern apprenticeship programme in 2012 has often been brought up in this chamber, and rightly so. It goes to show what can happen if care is not taken to maximise the potential of everyone in our society. There is little doubt that Scotland's job of the future lies in the science, technology, engineering and maths sector, as others have mentioned. It is no secret that the levels of occupational segregation in this corner of the economy are staggering. Last year, only 6 to 8 engineering apprentices were female. In 2015, the Government's own Maximising Economic Opportunities for Women in Scotland report demonstrated that 73% of female STEM graduates did not work in their respective fields after graduation. A few months ago, I said in a speech in your chamber that it used to be the advances in science and technology liberated women, but now they have the potential to hold them back. What I never followed up with, but in retrospect should have, was that this would also hold back our economic growth and aspirations for inclusive growth and opportunities for all. To conclude, few across this chamber would oppose economic growth, but economic growth for the sake of economic growth is a rather hollow ambition. The Government have taken some encouraging steps within the Scottish economic strategy to broaden the beneficiaries of growth in Scotland, but we believe they must be bolder. Our Parliament has significant powers over procurement and other areas which have yet to be utilised. We have full control over all matters concerning education, and as the opposition, it is our responsibility to say that government has thus far failed to use these powers to promote opportunities for all. The Scottish Government should not have to come out and tell us what their political priorities are. They should be evident in their budget and legislation. At the moment, they are simply not.
Thank you, Mr. McMahon. I now call on John Swinney to wind up the debate. Deputy First Minister, till five.
Presiding Officer, I don't in any way want to do any damage to Claudia Beamish, but I have to say that I enjoyed her thoughtful speech this afternoon. I probably spent the weekend following her advice of spending time with family and nature, in that I had to fulfil a government commitment in Lough Boisdale on Saturday afternoon and decided, instead of spending the weekend with the government entourage, I would take my family with me, and it was incredibly better for the prospect. So I hope none of my private office will take umbrage at what I've just put on the parliamentary record, but it was indeed a pleasant way to spend a couple of days on government business. One of the points that Claudia Beamish made, with which I agree, because she was making a point about the breadth of the focus of our work, and particularly in the assessment of the performance, not just of the government's delivery of its agenda, but of the impact of the collective activities that the government, local authorities, public bodies and a whole variety of other players are involved in terms of enhancing the quality of life of people within Scotland. And that is the context within which we have got to consider many of the issues around the economic performance of Scotland. And Claudia Beamish went on to apply that in a number of different areas in relation to the rollout of the Common Agricultural Policy, the importance of land reform, which I saw vividly in the Western Isles on Saturday, because I was visiting a venture taken forward by the community ownership company, the community interest company Storrs Uist at Lough Boisdale, where a £10 million project, which I think most dispassionate observers would have thought was pretty unlikely to get off the ground, has actually been successfully delivered to create new harbour and marina infrastructure, which will create significant foundations to economic recovery in what's a very fragile part of the Western Isles. So it is correct to look at this, and Patrick Harvey, of course, raises these issues about the breadth of the economic impact and the breadth of economic analysis that has to be considered into the bargain. So it's right to look at these questions in that way, and I thought Claudia Beamish made that point very powerfully in the speech that she delivered in Parliament today. I thought it was also made very powerfully by my colleague Joan McAlpine in relation to the example that she cited of the specific venture of the cafe project, The Usual Place, in her constituency, which served two purposes. One, it added another cafe to my encyclopaedic knowledge of cafes in Scotland, which I must visit and pledge to do so, but also about the fact that many social enterprises, and Mary Scanlon made this point as well, many social enterprises, whilst running profitable businesses, make a profound impact on the lives and the well-being of individuals who many mainstream businesses find it rather difficult to reach. And I think that's been a particular element of the direction I've given to economic policy in Scotland over the last 8 years, where one of our priorities was to expand significantly the social enterprise sector. And the analysis that Joan McAlpine talked about the social enterprise census, which gives us really quite fantastic analysis about the strength of the social enterprise sector in Scotland, and also the fact that the social enterprise sector is viewed as being world-leading here within Scotland, and the World Social Enterprise Congress this year again has focused on the leading work that is undertaken here in Scotland, which is something that we should very much welcome. And it illustrates perfectly the example of The Usual Place that Joe McAlpine raised. It illustrates perfectly the point the government is making about the emphasis on inclusive growth within the Scottish economic strategy. Now, a lot of the debate has concentrated around the areas of engineering and oil and gas activity. And I thought, in amongst some of the commentary about the
performance of the engineering sector and the manufacturing base of Scotland, Stuart McMillan's points about the welcome news of additional orders in Ferguson are an illustration again of the success that we can deliver in improving the depth of the skill base in Scotland and the economic performance of Scotland as a consequence. And of course, Ferguson's is only in place because of very concerted and focused activity by ministers, ably responded to by Jim McCall, in making sure that we still have in Scotland, on the Clyde, engineering capability that can build ships of the scale and the magnitude that we can now contemplate at Ferguson Shipyard. And that's an illustration of active government economic policy that has brought that about. Now, there are a number of comments made about the oil and gas sector, and I think Tavish Scott contributed significantly to the debate on the role of the Oil and Gas Authority. I had a very constructive meeting with the Oil and Gas Authority just last week, and some of the suggestions that Tavish Scott made about the fiscal regime to encourage exploration and development, particularly through the use of capital allowances, are suggestions that we welcome and that we will advance in our wider discussion on the future of the sector. But I thought, of course.
Neil Findlay.
I wonder if in those discussions he had some conversations with the employers about potential impending industrial action in the North Sea.
I did, because I was anxious to avoid such industrial action taking place. And what I was anxious to encourage was the type of climate which is embodied in the Fair Work agenda that's taken forward by the Scottish Government, which is about encouraging employers and employees to focus on the shared interest that they both have in guaranteeing progress. And if there's ever a sector that needs everybody to be rowing in the same direction, it's the oil and gas sector today. So Mr Scott's point, I'll come to Mr Harvey in a minute, Mr Scott's point about the, which I think is a point well made, and it's a siren warning to everybody, that if there is premature a withdrawal of activity in certain areas, that will jeopardise central infrastructure in the North Sea, and that will be to the detriment of everybody. So therefore, we need to have a cohesive approach in this respect. I'll give way to Mr Harvey.
Patrick Harvey. I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary. He may not be surprised that we're not, in fact, all rowing in the same direction. The previous climate change minister in the Scottish Government had at least finally accepted the scientific reality that the world has to leave most of its fossil fuels unburned. Is that still the view of the Scottish Government, and what proportion does he think is responsible to extract?
Well, Mr Harvey knows that the Government is committed to responsible and sustainable extraction of oil and gas reserves in the North Sea, because what that enables us to do is to anchor many of the sophisticated engineering opportunities of which many of my colleagues have talked about earlier on. Presiding Officer, as part of the discussion on oil and gas, Rob Gibson raised the issue of the alternatives, the developments, very much addressing the issues that Mr Harvey was raising and the point that Jackie Bailey made about the post-oil economy. One of the difficulties, and this is not about blaming somebody else, I think it's just a statement of fact, the prospects of securing greater opportunities for the renewable energy industry in Scotland are now today more difficult because of the actions of the United Kingdom Government than they were before the United Kingdom Government was elected in May of this year. And that is something which the Energy Minister, Fergus Ewing, will be pursuing with Amber Rudd, the UK Energy Minister, when he meets her in due course to address some of these points. The debate has been characterised, I would have to say, by a number of thoughtful contributions, but an awful lot of negativity from the Labour Party. We had 6 minutes 57 seconds from Jackie Bailey before she said we must now think about the future and being positive, and then went back into being negative again. If we could get to a position where the director of the CBI in Scotland, Mr Hugh Aitken, can see the government's economic strategy rightly prioritised making Scotland more competitive by investing in infrastructure, education and apprenticeships, and Graham Smith, the STUC General Secretary, can say the STUC enthusiastically welcomes a strong commitment to tackling inequality, which infuses the refreshed government economic strategy. The government economic strategy is improved and strengthened by the introduction of Fair Work as a key priority. Now, if we can get both the director of the CBI in Scotland to be positive about the Scottish economic strategy and the Secretary-General of the STUC to be positive about the economic strategy, then I remain optimistic that one day, somewhere over to my left, somebody may be able to say something positive. The Labour Party even wanted to remove. The Labour Party, in their amendment, and Jackie Bailey was kind of railing against this from my friend Stuart Stevenson when he made this point, the Labour Party even wanted to remove from the motion the statement that we welcome the fact that the Scottish economy has experienced its longest period of uninterrupted economic growth since 2001. Can the Labour Party not just accept the fact that the government's economic strategy is delivering positive returns for the people of Scotland and get behind us in our efforts?
Thank you. That concludes the debate on progress in the Scottish economy. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 14171 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a revision to the business programme for Wednesday, the 9th of September. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 14171.
Formally moved.
No members asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 14171 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of two Parliamentary Bureau motions. Can I ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 14163 on substitution on committees and motion number 14172 on referral of an SSI?
Moved on block.
The questions on these motions will be put at decision time, to which we now come. There are five questions to be put as a result of today's business. Can I remind members that in relation to today's debate on progress in the Scottish economy, if the amendment in the name of Jackie Bailey is agreed, the amendment in the name of Murdo Fraser falls. The first question then is amendment number 14156.3 in the name of Jackie Bailey, which seeks to amend motion number 14156 in the name of John Swinney on progress in the Scottish economy be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The vote on amendment number 14156.3 in the name of Jackie Bailey is as follows. Yes, 33. No, 77. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The next question is amendment number 14156.2 in the name of Murdo Fraser, which seeks to amend motion number 14156 in the name of John Swinney on progress in the Scottish economy be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 14156.2 in the name of Murdo Fraser is as follows. Yes, 12. No, 98. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14156 in the name of John Swinney on progress in the Scottish economy be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast votes now. The result of the vote on motion number 14156 in the name of John Swinney is as follows. Yes, 60. No, 50. There were no abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14163 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on substitution on committees be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14172 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on referral for an SSI be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We now move to members' business. Members who are leaving the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.